All right, guys, I'm gonna kick this off here. So I think we've established everyone here is mostly on Lightroom CC, or there's one person on 5 and one on 4, so everything should be pretty relatable. If you're on a previous version of Lightroom and you're not being able to follow along with certain things, it won't be for long. Most of the stuff is all pretty core operation for the software. All right. How many people are working with photos in a way that they're delivering images to a client, or they're just doing it for fun? Like, so show of hands, who is doing work for people in the room? Starting to, yeah. And then we have a few people who are doing it for hobby. Okay. How important to you is the backing up of the images? Is it something you guys think about? Are you worried about, if I lose this hard drive, I'm going to be on the hook for all these people's images? Have you had that thought come across your mind? Is that something we're thinking about? And did everybody get a chance to read that email that I sent out a few days ago regarding the type of equipment you should start thinking about looking at in terms of how to back up your images? And it's, none of it's required, but I do want to get you thinking about the types of things you're going to need to be working with if you're going to be taking people's money and they're going to expect a deliverable from you, because you have to start thinking about how to take care of these images, how to make sure that they're going to get what they're paying for, and that they're not that they are going to actually see these images to the end. So I want to get you guys thinking about the hard drives and stuff. I'm going to touch on that next. So what we're going to start with is, what is a catalog? Does anybody here know what a catalog is, or have an idea of what its function is? And if you don't have an idea, I'll go ahead and jump right into it. A catalog is a database that basically it is telling the software, it's keeping track of all your assets. It's keeping track of what images you have, all your raw files. It's a set of instructions telling what your software, what to do to the raw files. And our raw files, think of them as like undeveloped film. If you remember the film days, you'd have a raw, film image, your undeveloped, your unprocessed film. You would take that into the Lightroom, you would have to process it and then develop it. Pardon me?
You said Lightroom.
Darkroom. You take it into your darkroom. I know, it's not a funny play on words. You would take it into a darkroom, you would burn and dodge it to lighten and darken parts of the image. All of these things had to be done to process the photo. Essentially, we know that's how Lightroom works, is that we're doing a virtual darkroom, but it's all done digitally. So a catalog, when we create a catalog, when we create a catalog, what we're doing is it's a rallying point for all of your images. When we create a catalog on the on Lightroom, it's a home for all of your images. So there's a few different ways to run a catalog on your computer. The number one way we can start by doing, you can do a catalog, a master catalog, and run all of your images into that master catalog. So you create a catalog in Lightroom on your drive, and you'll import everything that you bring from your photo shoot. So you'll start with one photo shoot, and then you'll do another photo shoot, and then you'll shoot a wedding, you'll shoot a portrait session. Everything starts to come into that one master catalog. That's one way of managing your catalog. Another way of managing a catalog is you could do one catalog per photo shoot. So that's the way that I do it. What I like to do is when I do a photo shoot and I do a wedding, I come into the computer and I create a new catalog for it, and I import only the images from that catalog into Lightroom, into that one master catalog. So let's talk hard drives first. How many people, who is importing all their images onto their hard drive on the computer? And is anybody importing the images onto an external drive?
No, I'm sorry. I only put it on the external hard drive.
Okay, so I have a recommendation for you if you're doing it that way. What you should be doing is importing, you should be looking at getting some form of external storage. And I brought a few different methods of external storage that I'm using and that I want to pass on to everyone. So I did link everybody to this. And so the number one thing that I'm working with right now is this dual bay external dock, if you can see this. And it plugs into your USB port on your computer. And so I have this on my desktop at home. And I work between a laptop and a desktop. And I'll share the images back and forth between the laptop and the desktop all through this external. So if I wanted to work on something on my laptop, I can share those drives with my desktop. And I'm working on those catalogs that are following this drive around. So you don't have to work on your hard drive on your computer. So if you're doing that currently, I definitely advise that you look into some form of external backup. One way people do it is external hard drives. You can use these little portable hard drives like this. Which some of you might be using already. This one's an SSD. It's very fast. It's a very fast drive to work on. And so what I do is I start with a main working drive. And I'm trying to give you guys a very accessible way of working with your files. Like, ideally what we should be doing is you can work what's called a mirrored pair. It's a fancy term called a RAID array. And you can mirror these two drives together and they work in a pair. And so should one drive fail, the other drive will live on. And so if you lost work on that on those pair of drives, the work will still live on because you had them in a work configured pair. So you could actually then get another drive, reintroduce it to the one that's already been still remaining, and recreate that paired drive you have. So it will always function as a backup. That can get a little costly, but we're looking at like $66 for a 2 terabyte drive. I use a Seagate 2 terabyte drive, and I think the cost on the drives has gotten down pretty low. I find them almost disposable. It's a cost to my business, and I'm totally comfortable with the idea that maybe one drive will fail and I'll have to replace it. So if you needed to function with these drives, you should operate with a pair of drives, roughly $130, and you could have a mirrored copy of your drive and work like that. That's the ideal way to work. I wouldn't recommend working with a drive that is larger than 2 terabytes. You can buy 3, 4, 5, and 6 terabyte drives. I don't recommend anything higher than 2 because the failure rate goes up significantly once you get up into past 2 terabytes. 2 terabytes is a sweet spot where you still have a large enough hard drive to work with all these images, and your failure rate is lower, so you're not assuming as much risk with your images. In the last 3 years, I've filled up, I'm working on drive 7 and 8 right now. I've filled up 6 drives already, 2 terabyte drives, 12 terabytes of photos from shooting full time for the last 3 years. So if you're not shooting with that kind of frequency, a 2 terabyte drive could probably last you the better part of a year, I would hope. So then you might even get to the end of a year and start thinking, oh, I'll just start a new drive for next year, and your drives could start, you can start cataloging your drives year by year. So if you're not prepared to pick up drives in pairs, because that's $130 every time you want to buy these drives, one of these external bays probably runs me, I think these run about $50 to $75 depending on the brand. I referred everybody to one online the other day. I think it was like $36. So they're relatively affordable. And once you get that initial investment out of the way, you can start putting these drives in them. And now I can hot swap them. And so what I'm using is, these are bare hard drives. They're not guarded in any way. I wouldn't wave this in front of a magnet or any kind of electrostatic discharge. They are vulnerable in that way, but I keep them in these $5 cases that I get. They're impact and static proof cases that I get on Amazon, and I'll link everybody to some of the recommended things that you need to purchase afterward. But this is how I store these, and I'm super protective about these. If I'm leaving on vacation, I hide them under carpets, I hide them under couches, under my bed. I'm really, and ideally I should have a safe, but I'm really protective about these drives. So when I'm gone, I do my best to like conceal these drives and make sure they're safe, because they have client data on them. They're very important to me. So I have another method for you that might be a little more accessible in terms of how to keep a running backup of your files. And so what you could do, and this is what I did initially because I wasn't financially prepared to spend double the money I wanted to on every set of drives. So what I would do is when I'd come home from a wedding, I had a master drive, and I named them photo 1, photo 2, photo 3, and this is photo 5 right here. And then I also kept a backup drive, and the backup drive was only an initial backup for when I got the work into my computer. So once I got all the wedding files under one drive, I would then copy and paste it to my backup drive, and I would not touch that backup drive until the work was finished. When the work was finished and I completed and delivered the finished photos to the client, I would then go and delete the backup file to clear space for more incoming work. So no, whatever ongoing work I had that was open, I always kept a backup of it. And this is a bad way, not the greatest way to do it, because if in the middle of working on one of my weddings, the drive failed, I'd have to go back to the origin point and work with the original files that I had. But my reasoning was at least I had some type of last ditch, like I could get these files if I had to. So this is my poor man's way of keeping a backup set of images while you're working on client work. So once I was done, I uploaded things to a cloud database service. Have any of you heard of like Zenfolio or Shutterstock? Zenfolio, for example, has a professional service where I can upload unlimited images, finished images, JPEGs to Zenfolio. So I'll do 100% full-size JPEGs, finished work. That's my final step. Upload that to Zenfolio, knowing that if I ever lost any of my hard drives, the finished client work would be recoverable. Someone could always get a disk from me of their wedding in the future should they need to. So once it was online, once the client had their work, backup hard drive, I would delete those original set of images. Meanwhile, the working drives I had continued to grow. I accumulate more work on them, and then when I'd fill the drive up, I would buy a new drive and start filling that up. But I always had enough space to work with the active work on my backup drive. So does that make sense to everyone what I'm saying about how to keep an active backup? Sure.
When you're saying you're backing everything up, are you backing up raw files?
Everything, yeah. Like every image that I photographed.
You're duplicating it also?
So initially what I would do is if I finished a wedding and I photographed 3,000 images from a wedding and I didn't get a chance to pick the best ones yet, I'm literally talking the entire shebang.
Put them all in one place and then
I put them on my main working drive. This is where I'm going to create my Lightroom catalogs. This is where I'm going to start working on those files. I put them on that one drive. And then as soon as they were on that drive, I then pop this drive in and I would copy that entire folder to this drive. And I don't work on this drive. It's just a backup. But should drive 5 here fail, backup drive has that work that was open still. And I could go back and create a new hard drive, recover that work. So my whole idea was if I was working on something, there was always a backup. To make matters a little more complicated, most of my work gets done on one of these guys. This is a 250 gigabyte solid state drive. They're lightning fast. They connect through a USB 3.0 cable. Most of our laptops have that now. What I do is I work on this drive. Most of my active work is on this drive, also simultaneously existing on drive 5 at the same time. So my idea was that once I finish this work on this drive, that finished wedding, I would overwrite the remaining files that were on my big hard drive here. And so I really had 3 copies of this work open at any one time. And I was talking to Micah about it earlier. He keeps 2 to 3 active copies of his work. You just never know. I'm planning for Armageddon, but usually, you know, I haven't had any problems with losing any work yet. If I did, I wouldn't be in business anymore. So any questions before I talk about the next thing?
Why did you tell me this like 3 weeks ago?
What? Did something happen?
No, I kind of like threw away some raw files for a wedding and I didn't. I mean, I saved all the tape.
Sure.
I know that's the whole thing, you know, but. And
yeah, it's a whole different thing. And we're looking to break some old habits, create some new good ones. It really is process learning and trying to teach yourself new muscle memory, how you use your mouse, what your hotkeys are.
You know better, and you still don't do it. I was just lazy and not getting it.
Sure.
I have the Excel brush. I just never put
it. Yeah, and I know I've lost work. 11 years of doing this, I've lost work once maybe. And that's all it took for me to realize I can't let that happen again. There's nothing worse than an upset client because you didn't take care of their images. So
on your camera, do you have dual card readers?
I do have dual card readers. Okay. That's a good topic too. A lot of our newer cameras and some of the ones that are more slanted towards pros have dual card slots. I work with a Nikon D750, dual card slots in both my cameras. And so I copy raw files to both cards. They're duplicates of each other. When I get home from a wedding, two of those cards in those cameras come with me. They go into, I have a little hard case for them. I slip them in here. And if I don't get them on my computer, they go under my pillow because I'm crazy like that. And then the other two picture cameras stay within the camera. So if I'm out and about the next day and I didn't get a chance to do it, they're still in the camera. So I'm looking for redundancy and ways to protect the images. Even when I'm starting just the memory cards, it all starts there. Some of these cameras though, like this one I have right here doing our video, it's only got one card slot in it. That's it's a risky take, but that's why it's not a pro camera per se.
And so I'm just kind of going through the whole process. So
sure.
You got two cards, you get home, you're going to take one of them, and before you open up Lightroom or anything, you're going to put in that card and immediately just copy and paste every file on there to an external hard drive.
Yes.
You would import everything.
Okay, so there's a few ways, and that's where I'm getting to next. There's a few ways to do this. We could be importing all of these images in Lightroom immediately. Like I could start make a new catalog on my hard drive, and I could make a new hard catalog, and I could import those files off that memory card. That could be my first step. It's an extra step. It's a barrier to access. What I really want to do is just get those pictures off that memory card, put them on a drive. So I'm using, if you're on a Windows or a Mac, I'm using Finder or Explorer to create my own file structure and dropping those files in there as quickly as possible. That's how I do it. You could.
Now, if you find it easier to, like you said, for each shoot, you go out, you create a catalog for each shoot that you do.
Yes.
So you find that easier than
having a master catalog.
One master catalog with subcategories for
yes.
each shoot.
I'll explain both methods and I'll explain why I do it my way, because you heard me say I could have 2-3 copies at a time moving around. Imagine managing all that, and the master catalog is on one drive, but now I'm working on the hard. It's hard to manage where your catalog is if you're working on one big catalog and your files are over here and they're on another drive, they're on another drive. What I do is I work from one catalog for one shoot, and those files stay with that catalog. So if I got to move it from one drive to another, I can then go to that drive, new drive, open that catalog, and access those files without any problems. If you built a catalog on your C drive and you are putting all your raw files on your external drives, your catalog doesn't exist with those external files. It exists on your hard drive. So when I disconnect that hard drive, it's now saying, where are these images? You'll see a little exclamation point. Where are these images? And it starts looking for them. It can't find them. That's why I can't work that way, is because I don't work off a master catalog and then have everything on external drives. I move files around all the time. So I those raw files never leave the side of that catalog. So that way my catalog is always accessible with its files. It's meant to stay that way. So I'll show you. I'm going to get into basic file structure, and this is going to be harder for our Apple friends because I'm on a Windows PC, but the idea is the same. So I'm going to plug in my dock here. Oh, it's weird. And bear with me when I talk too fast or ramble or struggle for my next thoughts. This is all new for me, presenting with you guys, so we'll get there. And what really helps is if you look at me like I'm crazy. Drop your jaw, just stare right into my eyes. Okay, so I think I'm all plugged in. And the thing about external hard drives, you're probably familiar with your desktop's hard drives, the externals that plug into your USB port, and they have a power supply. Imagine if we had 10 of those things. How many slots do you have on your extension cord, your power supply underneath your computer? It's a lot to manage. What I like about this docking system is I have two docks at home, is I can swap out drives. I'm not using every drive all the time. So this is how I manage it. So I'm going to show you how I break down my photography on a hard drive. This is where it all begins. We start here on your main drive. It could look like this on your Mac too. So this is my Photo 5 drive, and most of this work is from 2015. I break it down and I number them here. I want to keep the, I know these are all my photo folders. It's just my wacky system. You don't have to adopt it this way, but I know once I start giving names to these folders and it's alphanumerical, that if I have any other folder on there, they start to get separated from each other. So I just want immediately, my first seven folders here are all photography folders. So I have a folder called assignment, and these could be editorial work that I get. E-sessions are my engagement sessions. Non-assignment, that's stuff I'm doing for fun. It's no one else's work. Portrait, if I'm doing portrait sessions with people. I do some real estate. I do a lot of weddings. And then we can pretty much ignore this other stuff. That's just junk. I could probably hide it. So I'm mostly working in these categories. And then, so if I want to go into an assignment folder, these are all editorial jobs I did on assignment last year. And you go into e-sessions. These are e-sessions I did last year. These are portrait sessions I did last year. Weddings in here. And in each folder, and you can do this in Finder too, so if this doesn't make sense in Explorer, it is translatable to working in Finder. You could do your folder structure the same way. It's all the same. Apple ripped off Windows back in the day, so just kidding. So I could go into a photo shoot. Here's Broken Clover Tattoo. I did a photo shoot with these guys last year, and forget all these extra folders you see in here. All you need to know is that this folder right here, Broken Clover, is my catalog. And the catalog is right here, Adobe Lightroom. That's my catalog. If I double click on that right now,
real quick, do you have any programs outside of Lightroom that allow you to preview RAW files? So you don't just get the icon?
Yeah, actually, what version of Windows are you using?
Windows 10.
Windows 10? I believe you can build it into there. You can either download something, but I should be able to see. Oh, I can't on here. Oh, I can't. It's loading. Okay. You should be able to thumbnail your RAW files. Which camera are you working with?
Nikon D5500.
Yeah, it should. Windows 10 should be giving you the RAW file previews here. Is it not for you? Is it not doing that for you? You might need to right click, and you could right click and go to View Large Icons. On Mac, I'm not sure. Do you guys see a preview on your RAW files, or is it just like a little icon, no preview in the thumbnail in Finder? Yeah. That's something I'll follow up on afterward. Maybe I'll try to recall it. I'll remember on the presentation, but I'll see if you can build. It should be a part of the Windows shell, though. Like, you should be able to see that stuff. And it might be an Adobe thing. You might have to tell Adobe for RAW handling, might have to tell Windows, you know, display these thumbnails.
JPEG and RAW just for reference.
Just in this part of Finder.
Just so I can see the images that I want, and then I pull my RAW images in. And so, same thing. So, right next to it, you get the JPEG version of it.
Gotcha. Yeah. All right. Yeah, and I shoot only RAW. I don't shoot any JPEG backups, but that should be a functionality of the software. You could see it in Bridge if you want to open a Bridge, but then it's like we're using things to, yeah, why do it? So, and I don't know if I'm going to, maybe I'll open up Bridge because I want to open up an Adobe Camera RAW and edit just one picture quickly. But I really don't even get a look at these things beforehand. I just go ahead and create a catalog, and I import the images that were already transferred to that folder. So you're seeing this folder right here. I got Broken Clover Tattoo. The first thing I did after this photo shoot was I transferred all these raw files right into this folder. I didn't open up Lightroom and create that catalog. I could have done that first, but instead I wanted to get the pictures in there. That's how I work. Then I open up the Lightroom catalog, and I go ahead and I import those files that are in there. So that's how that works. So right now, this is Drive 5, Broken Clover catalog with Broken Clover images. They're together. I don't have any broken image links. Everything is there. It's accessible. I can find it. I can go in here, and now I can go into here, and I can find, I did this for Lululemon. I go in here. I open up Bar 3 is my catalog folder. I open up Bar 3. Bar 3 is with the Bar 3 images. There are no broken links. If I were to move these images, this entire folder, to another drive and work on it there, there's no broken links. That's the advantage of working with one catalog per set of images. I know photographers to work on one master catalog, and the only way I could see this really working is if you did one master catalog per drive. So if I the next drive I bought and started putting images on it, I could work on one master catalog and I could start organizing that way. But where things would start getting wonky is I work on these little portable hard drives, though. I want to work on my laptop. I can't copy the entire contents of a 2 terabyte drive onto my 250 gigabyte SSD. I work job to job. I couldn't export that whole drive with that master catalog. So that's why it doesn't work for me. If you're a studio where you work on one catalog and you work on these drives, you could do that and never have to have the same problems I have. But I work on a laptop, I work on my PC, I'm moving back and forth between computers, and I'm exporting things to drives that are smaller than the original drive they're coming from. So I can fit maybe like 5 or 6 jobs in this one hard drive and work on them.
Why you don't use a 1 or 2 terabyte?
Because I was cheap. That's another upgrade. I'll probably end up getting a 500 or 1 terabyte SSD eventually. It is a little limiting that I'm working on a 250 gig SSD. I had it laying around, and I put it in this enclosure, and I started working with it. So that's all that is.
So, because I'm like a beginner.
Sure, sure.
Technology. Mm-hmm. So basically, what you're doing is you're sticking your SD card in the computer, you're mm-hmm. going to Finder, and you're creating a catalog and naming it
create a new folder.
Smith Family.
Yep, new folder.
New folder, Smith Family, and you're getting the image and you're putting the images in there.
Yeah, and let's not call it a catalog yet because I haven't created a catalog. I'm just managing the folder space this is all outside of Lightroom. I haven't even started a Lightroom yet. So let's see. I'm gonna go ahead. We're gonna do this together right now. So I've got a memory card right now with a photo shoot on it, and I'm gonna put it in my card reader.
So you're bypassing the hard drive on your laptop altogether.
I'm not working on the hard drive on the laptop at all.
It has a big monitor for the most part.
Oh yeah, I mean it's functioning with this external here and with my little external SSD here. So what I'll show you my workflow. We'll start on something right now. All right, so we're gonna start from beginning. I just follow along here. We're gonna go. Let's see. So I opened up Explorer or Finder. I'm going into my drive. This is Photo 5. And the images on this drive, on this SD card right now, are engagement photos. So I'm going to go into my engagement folder session, engagement session folder. I'm going to create a new folder. And this couple was Naomi. How do you spell Naomi? That's a hard name to spell. Naomi. Naomi and Mike. I'm going to open that folder up, and now I'm going to go into my SD card. I'm going to right-click it and go into Open New Window so I can see a new window. So here's all the images from that shoot. And I don't need to see them all. I don't need to do all of them. I'm just going to do, like, a number of them here. And so let's say I grabbed them all right now, and I immediately – oh, jeez. grab that folder. And if you have images right now, this you're welcome to do this along with me. And I'm going to move those images into this new folder. And if you've got a USB 3.0 card reader and a relatively fast SD card or compact flash card, this doesn't take long to move big files. So it's probably better to get one of those high-speed card readers. It isn't a joke. They are a lot faster. And so I'm
going right from the SD to one of the opticals you got plugged into the hub.
Yes, I'm moving it to Photo 5 hard drive. Let's say that's my main active working drive right now. That's the drive I work on all the time right now. Let's say that. So now I have all these files. These are my raw files. They're in this folder now. I didn't do this inside Lightroom. I did it just because I want to get them as quickly as possible on the drive. I don't want to mess with Lightroom yet. And they might remain there for a little while until I can work on it. I don't normally work on stuff right away. I'm probably going to visit this, you know, a few days later. So now, say a few days' time has passed, I open up Lightroom. You know, it doesn't matter what catalog you're in. I'm going to start a new catalog. And I've got a lot of drives here. So I'm looking for Photo 5. There's Photo 5. I'm going to go into that eSession folder. And I'm going to go into Naomi and Mike's folder. And now I got to create a new catalog. So I'm going to call it Naomi and Mike eSession. And when I do this, I now Lightroom asks you to back up your catalog. You should do it, but this is old work. It's all done. I'm not backing it up now. All that does is it makes a recoverable file for your catalog should it be corrupted while you're working on it. On that drive.
Is that on the cloud somewhere? Or
no, it doesn't back up to the cloud. It's more like a recoverable file within Lightroom itself. So it's not to the cloud. So I'm gonna skip it. I don't need to do it. So now I've created a new Lightroom catalog. And what it does is it creates its own folder. So it's a little redundant. I know initially I could just go on the drive into eSessions, create a new catalog, and it'll make its new Naomi and Mike eSession catalog file at its own folder, and I could now import the images into here. That's one way to do it, but I'm backwards. I get the files on here first, and later I build my catalog. So you see, all our images are here, our catalog's here. Now I can move this folder, Naomi and Mike, to any other hard drive I want. They're always going to be together. They're married together. I keep them there. So now we have Naomi and Mike eSession. And what I would like to explain about a catalog and these raw files is your raw files are not, you know, you're familiar with Photoshop when you work with a PSD file and you start doing things like you draw on something on a layer and you use the clone tool and you fix a zit and you're physically affecting those pixels. When you save it, you can't revert back to whatever it originally was. You're saving over an iteration of itself. When you work with a raw file in Lightroom, you can do whatever you want to the Lightroom raw file. You will never damage the original state that image came in. So there's nothing you could do like, oh crap, how do I get back to whatever it was? Easy. You could always get back to your base settings, so how it looked coming out of your camera. Does that make sense to you? Mm-hmm. Okay. I just want to make sure if everyone's following. Or JPEG, yeah. If you were saving over a JPEG, it's lost. You're not going to recover that. But if you're working in RAW, you'll never damage your files. Never be afraid to hurt a RAW file. It's indestructible. And when we work in Lightroom, it's kind of like, I'm trying to like find a good analogy for it. Like, I think it's like the difference between fast food and catering. In catering, we prep all the stuff. We have a recipe for how the ingredients are going to look when it's done and cooked, but we don't do it right away. In fast food, like a fast food's like a JPEG. You order McDonald's and you get your cheeseburger. It's immediately in front of you. But with Lightroom and with raw files, we're creating a recipe and then giving instructions for each part of the image. And at the very end, all of it comes out at the end. But in my weird analogy, the raw files are like food that is indestructible and remains. Like you could like, it's a never ending supply of food that can, we messed that up. That's okay, go back to the original food. Like all week I'm trying to think of a good analogy for what a raw file is. So what Lightroom is doing is it's, you're not physically affecting pixels and moving stuff around, and I'm darkening here and lightening here. It's basically making a script. So every time I do that, Lightroom's writing it down. Okay, at this pixel, make it darker. At that pixel, make it lighter. At this pixel, it's making a whole list of instructions, and it's building what's called an XMP file. And that XMP file is a text document that accompanies your RAW file. And upon export, it is now referring to that set of instructions. Okay, I was supposed to do this and this to the file. And then my final deliverable, the final output, is a JPEG. In a way, it's like how we worked with light, in a dark room with film. We had a set of instructions. Like I used to see pictures of Ansel Adams, directions on what he would do to his processed film. He, you know, over here, burn plus three, dodge minus, you know, he had timing for how long he would do each part of it. And it was like a set of directions. And the final image was his desired result. In Lightroom, we're doing the same thing. So the result is until the very end when you export. Does that make sense to everyone? Is that a clear concept that we're not physically doing things to the RAW files along the way? We're just making a set of instructions for Lightroom to execute at the very end when we finally say export and get these files out. So.
Which you can duplicate over and over and over again. For the RAW.
Sure, I can make copies.
You can change those instructions at any point.
Yeah, yeah.
And you can re-export it and mm-hmm. have a different.
Set of examples, and I'm gonna get there. I'm touching on catalog creation now, in raw intake and file management, and then we're gonna get into the develop module. So I need to get moving along because I'm falling behind on my time here. So we talked about internal versus external, backing up, where to store your images. Now we're in our file and folder structure import. Okay, so now here's the big problem everyone has with images. Culling, and culling is where we pick what is our best images and get rid of what are our worst images. How many people work reductively? You've got all these images from a shoot. Say you have like 300 images. Do you start picking your best ones or do you start deleting your worst ones? Who deletes their worst ones? Anyways. All right. And the psychology of that is that when I get rid of these bad photos, I'm gonna have my best ones behind. What ends up happening is I have very similar groups of images that look all comparable, and I really should have just picked the best one out of that set. So what you should start doing, and it'll speed up your culling process, is we need to start picking our strongest images. And I've got a couple different software. We've got a couple different ways to cull. And I'm going to start with one. Is anyone here familiar with Photo Mechanic or has started working in Photo Mechanic? Anyone working with it? Okay, so I'm going to show you the software real quick. It's going to be a quick cull, and I'm going to show you what I'm doing to pick my best images real quick. So I have this program called Photo Mechanic. It's a $150 software title. It's a pricey piece of software for what it does, but it speeds up my workflow considerably. And you make Photo Mechanic right up here. So PHO2, yeah. So I'm going to go and find my Drive 5, wedding, I'm sorry, not wedding, engagement session, working on Naomi and Mike, and hit OK. So now I'm going to see all those images in this piece of software. So what this piece of software does that is really great, I need to get rid of all my, one second here.
At this point, would you have delivered these to your client for them to prove?
No. And I'll explain how I'm doing that. So that's another step. This is a tip I'll give you for client proofing, because what I do from a photo shoot is I don't give them 300 images to look at that were not blurry. From a photo session like this, they're going to see about 100 photos, and I ask them to pick their top 10, 15 images. Sometimes they might make it more, depends on how I'm feeling. Sorry.
But I guess my point is at this point, you would have already gone through whatever process you created with whatever relationship you have with your client. You've already established how you're going to have that communication with them. Like, okay, I'm going to show you X amount, you're going to tell me X amount. And you would take that information and what you want to provide them as far as deliverables and chop this list down?
Okay, so I'll show you what I do. So I'm going to start making my selections real quick, and this is going to be a very quick process. And what's great about Photo Mechanic is I can 100% zoom and see how sharp an image is where I want to almost instantly. Lightroom does not do it this quickly, and it's a major pain in my ass. I wish it would go faster. So I'll show you some images where I might make a quick selection, and I can zoom in. I hit the Z key. I can zoom in 100% and check sharpness right away. That's a sharp image. And so what I do for my tagging process is I tell it yes or no, and my yes or no is giving it a number one, and that's a number one star rating, or I don't rate it at all. And I've also programmed the software to, give it a rating, to advance to the next picture. So I don't have to press next picture. It immediately tags and I advance. So I'm going to check these images. That's sharp. I'm going to go through. That's a little redundant. These are all four similar images. So I'm looking for the sharpest one, probably that one. Here's them hanging out. They're sharp. Maybe I'm looking for expression. Closeness. He's grinning really hard, and I'm going back and forth. I'm scrolling. I'm looking very quickly. I'm making very quick decisions about how I want to use these images. I like these kiss photos, but maybe a little separation between them because when it's together, it's too dark. So like right there, I'll pick that one. Very quick selections here. These are all redundant. I already got similar images. Here's another set of images. Maybe I'll show them this one. They're sharp here. I like these pictures. They're all similar. Sharpest one doesn't matter. They're all close to being sharp. And this is my thought process. I'm very quick. Like, I don't fall in love with an image. If I even think for a second, nah, that's not a good image. Go move along. I took enough photos. I take enough variations of a pose that there's going to be one where I'm like, that's the one. Too dark in her face. A little light on her face here. It's still a little dark in her eye sockets. Maybe I like the cropping better on this versus that. I started playing with some stuff here I didn't like. She's pretty dark here. And in my camera, I can recover these shadows pretty good, so that might still be a good image. And that's a different orientation. They're both sharp. I like some foreground elements here. I started playing with some of this grass.
So now, are you shooting in like a 3-5
shot burst? Oh, I shoot. Every little grouping is probably pap, 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 because they're going to blink. They're going to not like the expression of their mouth in a certain way. I don't like my arm in this photo. I got to give variety. And I could be more deliberate, but sometimes I don't have that time. I just need to just push through the session. So I shoot, you know, this is 900 images from a 2-hour session, and they're going to see about 100 images. It's a little excessive, but I also shoot at like F2, F1.4. And if you are off focus just a little bit, it's the difference between a sharp image and fuzzy details. So I have to shoot a lot just for my, I'm gonna blow focus at some point here, and I gotta be prepared for that. So here's a kiss. They're a little soft, but I'm looking for a little separation. I don't like them macking so hard. I like a little separation. And then, all right, so I'm just gonna be a little more quick here.
So what's the major difference between this program and like flagging and unflagging and Lightroom?
In Lightroom.
Because it seems very similar.
It's fast. It's speed. It's purely speed. I can't do it this fast in Lightroom. But I'll show you that next. So this is my method for, you know, this is a software. You don't have to get this software title. You could do this all in Lightroom. So
when you pick your ones, those are the ones that you're working on.
Mm-hmm. So now what I do is, I keep looking up there, I can look right here. So what I do is all my selected images here, all the pink ones, those are images that I want to show them. Sorry, I'm looking for that drive. So Naomi and Mike, I'm going to make a new folder in here, and I'm going to call it Pics. And these are the folders. These are the images that I want to work with. So this is a way of categorizing your images. I removed all the untagged images, and I'm going to select all these, and I'm going to move them into my pick folder. So they're going to be gone. And so I'm left with all the images I didn't even use. So that's a lot of throwaway. This is very This is very a very vulnerable experience for me to show you all the stuff I'm not using. Yeah, these are the ones that didn't make the cut. This was my shit. So, all right. So that's my culling process. I do it every wedding. Every wedding, everything gets that.
So the ones that you do not pick, do you automatically reject those, or you just put them off to the side, or what?
I'll give you a little tip that I do here, because our hard drives start to fill up with pictures we don't like. So what I do is I make another folder. I call it toss. You can call it trash. And I move them. I move the remaining images into toss. And I didn't have to leave. I didn't have to move them into pics. I could have left them in the main folder and just made a toss folder. So you could do it either way. I just a creature of habit. That's how I do it. So now I've got a pic folder. Those are the images I want to work with. I've got a toss folder. Those are the images I want to throw away. So 4 months go by. That hard drive's looking like I'm looking at it. It's going 500 gigabytes left, 400, 300 gigabytes left. And now I'm wondering at the next wedding if I got enough room to move this wedding over onto it. I can go on that hard drive, do a search, delete all my toss folders. I can do a search for every toss folder and delete them all. So it's my way of like being able to throw out the trash later on for, you know, I got 80 photo shoots on one drive. I can delete all the toss folders later and clear up space again. So, but I'm a little neurotic. I worry that someday some client will be like, well, you had a picture of me sneezing and can you give me that photo? And you know, sure, I have it. So I tend to not throw away my toss folders unless I'm really in a crunch. Well, what I'll end up doing is buying another hard drive when I should have just deleted the toss folder. So that's my culling process. I did it out of Lightroom. It had nothing to do with Lightroom, but I was able to separate my good pictures from my bad pictures. Now we're going to go into the import process. So now we got our catalog, we've got our files separated. I'm going to go import photos and video. And I'm going to, and I never get the drive I want to show up here, so I got to go, actually I probably could, hold on. Photo 5, here it is. I'm going to look for Photo 5, E-Session, and what it's doing right now is my memory card is plugged in and it wants to import from the memory card. So if I undo the memory card, these pictures should have gone away. No, maybe not. Okay, oh, there they go away because it wants to import from memory card right off the bat. So now we go into E-Sessions, we go into Naomi and Mike, and I'm looking for my pic folder. That's my pics. And I'm going to import now.
So you're only importing your pics then?
I'm importing only my pics. So when I work in Lightroom, I did all my selection before I got into Lightroom. That's how I work. But that's probably not how you guys are working. You're probably importing all your images and doing your selections in Lightroom.
It sucks.
Because it's slow. There's a couple ways around this. So now let's forget that I did this real quick. I'm going to remove these images from this catalog. And I'm going to go in here and I'm going to import. I'm just going to import from my trash folder just for the sake of example. Let's see, I'm going to import my, so I'm going to get all these pictures in here, it's 160 images. So now we're importing them in here. And now we're in the library module. This is where a lot of our catalog stuff is going on. This is where we're moving files around. This is where we're managing the files. Oh, what's going on? Managing the files. So now I've got, so I wanted to pass on a way to do your selections here. And when I go in, and now we're in grid view, if down here, you can double click on an image and it'll take you into loop view, but you can go back to grid view down here. If you see the mouse, grid versus loop view. And so now we can start culling in Lightroom. So I can zoom in, zoom out, and see that loading icon, loading icon, loading icon, loading icon. I hate that icon. It means I'm wasting my time. But it's just what we got to deal with. So there is a tax to pay when it comes to this stuff. It's a time tax. And we can either pay the time tax at the beginning at our import or per image as we're navigating. So if you want to sit and check, wait for this every time, you can do that. And then decide, nope, I don't like that image. I'll go to the next image. You can do that. Or from the grid view, if you select all your images, you should be able to right click, go in here and, oh, it's under file. I gotta find it because I don't do it this way. Library, previews. We want to go to library, previews, and we can now do two different things here. We can do build one-to-one previews. This is full previews right now. Every image will now load 100% faster. You could do this, so I would advise, and this also takes up space, makes the catalog bigger, but if you got the time and you import your images after you created your catalog and you have them all here and you want to cull faster, you can go build one-to-one previews. And now we got this dialogue here, this preview pane, or this status of how long it's going to take. And it's moving pretty slowly. My laptop's relatively fast. And I'm going to guess this would probably take me, I don't know, maybe 10 minutes right now for 160 images. That's not a lot of images, and I have to wait like 10 minutes. If I had 1,000, I shoot 4,000 images from a wedding. I don't know how long it would take me to build one-on-one previews so I could see those images faster on when I'm culling right now. That's why I use Photo Mechanic, because this takes too long. I can't do that. But if you got the time initially, you know, you came from a shoot, you made this you made your catalog and you imported these images and you want to do your culling afterward, you can build your one-to-one previews and walk away from it and eat a piece of pizza and come back 20, 30 minutes later, maybe an hour.
So what I do is I bring all my images into Lightroom, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then I sit through and I go through, and once I start culling them, going through them, the ones that are blurry or whatever, I just mark them as rejected,
mm-hmm.
and I group them all together.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's almost the same thing you're doing, except that, I guess,
the rendering time.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, because it does take a little while.
So when you're doing that, you're waiting for it to load before you're like, okay, now I can see it's not sharp, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's painstaking.
And I'm having to go through the images a couple times. Cause mm-hmm. Like I said, the first time I'm going through them and just get rid of all the ones that are
sharpness,
whatever, just take notes, and I got to go through them again.
Yeah, and when I'm looking at images, I'm looking at it from an emotional standpoint. I'm like, do I like this image? And then I'm like, oh wait, is it sharp? No, it's not sharp. It doesn't matter if I like it or not. So I have those two factors at play when I'm culling right off the bat. And so I like working in Photo Mechanic because it's instantly fast. I'm not messing around. I'm building one-on-one previews for 160 images, and we could take a pizza break. You know, it's taking too long. But you know, that is just what you're faced with if you're trying to cull your images in Lightroom. You know, so I can just cancel this right now, and maybe I can just decide. There's another thing.
That would come in. This is invaluable.
Yes.
Like I said, when I was shooting for the U of A, you got a time span. You got a clock.
Yep. You got to be quick, especially in sports photography. They want to put that stuff to press within 30 minutes, and you got to get it online. I can't build previews. And sometimes you just got to send it out and let them figure it out.
$50 saves you time.
Yeah.
And a job.
Yeah. So I'm big on Photo Mechanic, and I didn't want everyone to come here to think about, oh gosh, what more crap do I got to buy? I got to spend $150 on the software, about $150 on hard drive stuff. You know, I don't want to send you with like a wish list of things to get. So if you're doing it in Lightroom, build your previews, walk away from your computer, come back, and now when I go into loop view and I zoom in, these already have some previews built because I did it already. So you see that loading? That just takes too long. Actually, I can tell that one's sharp right here. I'm moving forward a little bit, moving. Sometimes you'll see it go pixel by pixel up the line and to build the preview before you can tell if it's sharp or not. So if you're doing it this way, there are two keys we can press. I think it's P, flag as pick, or
X is delete.
X is rejected. And then later, so I'll just do that real quick. We're going to do some picks. And actually, you can also go in and set it to, let's see. This is a little trick for when you're culling. I just did it. Auto advance. So anytime you do a selection, I'm gonna pick this, I'm gonna hit P, next picture. I don't like that, X, next picture. I don't have to keep pressing left or right on the keypad. It's go to, was it photo, and click on auto advance. So now it'll speed up your calling, because I spend way too much time in front of a computer. I'm looking for any way to save milliseconds here, because the seconds start to add up, you know, seconds added to minutes and then hours. And that's one thing, that's one keystroke I'm removing when I had to do like 2, 3, 4,000 of them, you know. So reject, pick, you know, move forward. And then what I'm going to have at the end of all this, really, I just want to, I don't even care about doing the rejection. I just want to do picks, honestly. Go through and pick. And if you don't like something, move forward. Pick. Then when you get through the whole set of images, we will go to your grid view. And now we'll see these white flags everywhere. These white flags mean these are images we picked. The X black flag means we rejected the image. Unmarked stuff is still in there because I didn't hit picks on everything. But what I do now is we can now use a custom filter. These bottom right corner here, if you see that right there, we can go in here and we can start creating filters to start weeding out images and how we want to see them in our grid view here. So I'm trying to figure out the filter. Okay, so here's filter four. Filter based on flag status. Any flag status versus, let's see, I'll click on this. This should give me all our picks. There we go. So now I clicked on it, and now we have all our flagged photos. So this is all our picks right here. So now I'm looking at all of our images that we want to work with. And I could do something where now we want to figure out, we want to delete. You might want to work two different ways. You might want to delete your pictures that you didn't select, or you might want to just keep them in the catalog. I'm not sure how you want to do it, but that's a one thing to consider. I personally will want to delete the pictures I wasn't using, because if the more you have them in there, the more it starts to clutter up your catalog and it bogs things down. I don't like to have a lot of images in the catalog if I can help it. Question?
No, I was going to say, what I do is I number mine, right, the ones I want to keep, and I'm able to use the filter,
mm-hmm.
and I'm able to, like, if I give them a four that I worked on or I like,
yeah.
I can only look at, they'll only show me the fours.
Gotcha.
You know what I mean? That.
Sure. Yeah, yeah. Okay.
Because there's been times when I don't like a picture,
yeah.
and I deleted it, and then I went back and said, oh, you know what, I wish I had it, or there's a time when you know, I rejected it, whatever, but I was able to go back and do something else.
With sure. It, you know what I mean? Okay, so... Let's say, for sake of argument here, we just remove all our non-picked images. Let's just get rid of all our trash. So I'm getting rid of – I selected with these flags over here. Right now there's – you can always go over here to this check down and turn your filters off. And so we'll go back to our base. Like, you know, you'll see everything. I want to select our unselected images and our rejected images. So I've clicked them both here, and now I see our rejected and our non-selected images. I'm just going to select everything, Control A or Command A on an Apple, and hit delete. And it's going to say, do you want to delete them from the disk or remove them from the catalog? I always remove from the catalog and let them remain on the disk. If you're really feeling brave, you can delete them from the disk if you think you'll never use them again. So now when I turn off the filters again, we should be only left with our picked images. So this is the photos we want to work with right now. Is any part of this confusing as far as like how we're making our selections and what we're working with and how it's remained on the catalog when we're done? And does it make any questions? Good. Okay. All right. So forget I did all this real quick. I want to go back to those images I picked from Photo Mechanic. That's how I work. All right, so disregard what I'm doing here. I'm just going back to those images that I wanted to work with earlier because I like them. They're prettier. All right, so no matter how you did it, whether you culled before Lightroom in a program like Photo Mechanic or you culled in Lightroom, what we want to get to is a set of images we're going to work with. And I also wanted to mention, this is a good time to mention collections. So say you didn't delete all those rejected files that we had earlier. What I could have done is I could have picked our flagged photos with that selection here, and then Control A selected all those images that we filtered for that we wanted to work with, and I can now create a new collection. And collections are just ways of categorizing images and keeping them together. This is my way. So say I had all the rejected and unselected images. I can now create my set of images, call it pics. Include selected photos. So we're going to create that. So now, if you see over here in the left in collections, we now have a collection of images called pics. And you can do this other ways too. I can grab these images, make a new collection, call it ring photos. It's just another way of organizing your images. So now we're in ring photos over here is our pics. That was everything. Maybe I want to do one. New collection, people photos. And why we'd want to do this is say earlier we had all those rejected images still. Now I can go to the pics folder and only work on the pictures that we want to work with. This is also a good time once you have your selected images, this is a good time to go in and name them something different. Because right now they're all named 1JP4263.NEF. I could select them all, go to library, rename these folders, these images, and call them Naomi, Mike, and now hit OK.
Question, so now you would do that as opposed to keywording them?
You could keyword them. That's just a matter of organization. I like to do it to the files because now when we go to our eSession Naomi and Mike folder and go to pics, all those files now have been changed. And these are the files I know I want to work with. If it doesn't have that file name, it's not a file I want to work with. It's just a matter of organization. So earlier we were talking about how to let our client in on the selection process. Chris, you were asking about that. Here's what I do. I use Adobe Bridge. Find it. What's it doing here? Turn off. There we go. That's weird. We're about to get to the good stuff. Like once we get this stuff sorted out, where I'm going to start talking about the develop module, and we're going to now we're going to see all the cool stuff. Like that's where we get to like apply some effects to the images. I'm going to teach you how to build presets and how to work with presets, and it's going to be all the good stuff's coming. That's where we start to really do stuff to our images. So what's going on up there? Oh, there we go. And the next part, I really would love for you guys to work on your computers along with it, because I'm going to show you how to do some things. All right. So this is the one thing that I would use Adobe Camera Raw for. Adobe Bridge, which this is actually a gateway to Adobe Camera Raw. This is one way you can open into Camera Raw from Bridge. But I use Bridge to create proof sheets for my clients. Bless you. Let's see. So photo 5, assignment, eSession, Naomi and Mike, pics. Now we see all our images here. And for some reason, Adobe took this feature out of Adobe CC Bridge, and you have to find it on their website, but it's easy to do. You have to reacquire the output module. They took it away. This used to be standard on everything, on every Bridge beforehand, but you'll have to like do some research how to install output module on Bridge, and I can help you guys with that if you want to try.
Lightroom has contact sheets also.
Yeah, they do.
Right, you like theirs better?
I like this. You'll see what I'm about to do. It's I do a PDF proof sheet. You can do, you know, you can do on US paper, 8.5 by 11 size, 300 DPI. And you can put, you can actually put your own header and footer on this. I usually put my website name in there, and you can select your spacing. So I want like four rows, four columns, five rows of images with auto. Oh, come on. And I'll tell it to save. Actually, view PDF. I'll tell it to save, and I'll usually save it to Dropbox. And I create a proof sheet with it. I hit save. It generates a proof sheet with all the thumbnails in there. And this is what I email to my client. I send them this, and I tell them to write down, write their top 10 numbers down. They don't got to give me the whole name, just top 10. And now, so they say they pick 1, 5, 7, and 15. I go back into Lightroom. I know number 5. I'll give it a 5-star. Give it a 5-star. I 5-star the images they picked. Mm-hmm. And now that's my next criteria to work with those images. So I leave it up to them to pick from that proof sheet. That's what I email them. They can also zoom in like 400, 600%. They can get a pretty good look at these images. So they're going, you know, they're not looking for sharpness. They're looking for how they feel about the image. So this could be a great way to take a lot of stress off yourself and not be picking for your clients, because they will pick everything. You will pick everything. You'll be like, I like this, I like this, I like that. And they will pick completely different images. I find all the images I love, the client didn't pick them. I'm like, wow, I thought that was the best image from the set. They have no emotional attachment to it the way you do. So you may as well let them pick, and then you'll find that the number is more easy to manage of images delivered. And that you can throw in a few extra images because you probably already started doing something to it anyway. I like this image. I'll throw it in with their coverage, you know, and they'll thank you for it later. So I don't like to give more than 15 to 25 images from a session, depending on the quantity of photos we took and the different kinds of looks. But sometimes I get generous, and the photos are easy to edit. So and I'm about to show that. So that's how I do my proofing process with clients. I don't know if anyone else encountering proofing with clients yet? Is that something you guys are looking at doing? Yeah. Does that sound helpful?
Yeah.
And so that's the output module on Adobe Bridge CC. So you have to have that module installed. You can acquire it online. It's free. You just gotta install it. It's an extension you have to add. So all right, the develop module. This is my favorite module. An hour and 10 minutes to get here. I promise you, once you start doing these methods and you start this process of creating these habits of building your catalog, importing your images, building your catalog, that stuff is easy. The longest part is getting the images onto your drive and waiting for it to transfer. Then you can make your catalog immediately, or you can make your catalog while those images are transferring. Just get that catalog ready. When those photos are done, import them in. And you know, culling was the other part of it that's hard. So if you're using Photo Mechanic, it's quick. If you're using Lightroom to do it, it's a little slower, but you can still get there. So maybe when you're culling, you could go in here to your grid view, hold the control key, I think it's the same on your Mac, and blow up your thumbnails a little bit and start looking for images you like just off appearance alone, and maybe just start going off of feeling rather than going off of sharpness, and you can check for sharpness later. You know, it's wishful thinking, but I just don't know any other way to make this a less of a pain in the ass experience. Culling is probably the hardest, biggest obstacle to getting to work right away. So I want to get my best images and figure out what they are right away. So Photo Mechanic is it for me. So let's go to the develop module. Oh, and I made some 5-star selections down here. Let's go ahead, and I want to filter for 5-star images. We're in my pics folder. Let's see. So filter, if you click on the 5-star right now, you got to double click it. It now left me with only the 5-star rated images down here. These are my 5-stars now. Usually it's a little more, it's a lot more than that. Okay, so who works with presets? Show of hands.
Yes.
Yeah, and any favorite ones that we like to work with? Maybe some you've acquired online? Did you buy any presets somewhere?
Greater than Gatsby.
Yeah. Mastin is a popular one. Mastin. I use VSCO, the VSCO ones. And SLR Lounge has got a huge supply of presets. So, SLR Lounge. So I find that the preset process, there's like a stigma with presets. People are like, oh, you use presets? Hell yes, I use presets. I don't know if you've ever had to edit 800 images, you know, in a week. Yes, I use presets. And the reason I use presets is they are not the answer to your images. They are just a starting point. None of us here has spent the time building each of these presets. There is camera calibration, color and hue and set. There is a lot of things at work. And that's why the people at those companies that have made those presets have done that for us. They've decided we're going to emulate these film looks, and this is a directory of presets to emulate film look, or these are presets we've built that give interesting or compelling stylistic looks. They're all starting points, so it's not your end all. I can't just apply a preset and walk away from these images. I wish. It would be so great. But I do have a starting point. And so you'll see over here, I've got a long list of VSCO presets, and they have them and they're all kind of mirrored presets of different cameras. They're all very similar, and I've been kind of working with the same one. I should probably fix this up a little bit because I went from Canon to Nikon, but I'm still using the Canon VSCO preset. I'm sure there's someone at VSCO that would tell me why that's not a good idea, but I haven't seen anything problems with it. So I've got a favorite one, I've right-clicked on it, and you can actually rename it. I added the word favorite to it, so that way I can readily spot it every time in that list of presets. So right off the bat, pretend there's 800 images here. I click on my favorite preset, this one. And it really didn't do much to the image, but I also have another preset that I have for a custom tone curve. Tone curves are over here. That's where we start playing with it, and you can adjust the tonality of the image. You can you can lower the amount of highlights on the image, or raise the amount or lower the amount of shadow points. Like, you can do all kinds of crazy stuff over here with that. So I'm going to reset this image. So I'm looking for a starting point. So I have my preset. Favorite here, and then I have one of these. I have a custom tone curve, and what that does is, you see, it's really crush muted look. It's kind of hard to see on the screen here. It's better on my laptop, but that's my baseline. And I immediately, right off the bat, I control A, I select everything in the set, and I right click. I'm sorry, and I go to here and I sync it. I sync all the major settings. I don't care about white balance being synced because they could all be different, but I want to sync highlights, shadows, white clipping, tone curve. This is pretty much the majority of the look is what I'm syncing here. So I'll hit synchronize. So now all of these have that base look embedded in them. And I'll go a little further. What I'm looking for right off the bat, I like to pull back on highlights quite a bit, and I like to push shadows quite a bit. And then I'll go ahead and sync them all real quick. So that's my base. I start working with the preset. So now, as you can see, that didn't really fix the image. It wasn't like a magic button and presto, now my image is ready. So now, what I'm looking for right off the bat, you got to be diplomatic with your time with these images. You can spend a lot of time on one photo, but when you have like 800 to do, you know, you don't want to break your back over one photo if you can be quick about it. So one thing I'm looking for right off the bat, exposure. That right there fixed most of the problems I have with this issue. The highlights I'm okay with. I'm pretty aggressive in pulling back on highlights. If you do it to an image where your highlights are blown, you'll start to get clipping in the highlights. So you'll see, like, it'll be muddled tones where, like, you really can't recover an image that's blown out. So this image has a lot of recoverable highlight data still. I can pull it back all the way. The shadows, I'm okay with the image of the shadow. I can push them a little more. You see what it does. I have a lot of leeway in these Nikon RAW files. You can really push shadows. Maybe I'm looking at contrast a little bit. I don't really play around with whites or blacks too much because our tone curve has the strongest effect on whites and blacks, and I've already I've already crushed the tone curve. I've brought up the darkest black point and I've brought down the brightest white point. So there's really no need to play with whites and blacks when I've already got a custom tone curve built in. So quickly, what I'm looking for when I get into an image, I'm looking for white balance. Is it too hot? Is it too cold? I want to correct white balance. Maybe I like a little bit more a warmer bias. I can go here and warm it up a little bit. Is it too magenta? Is it too green? I find my bias to be a little on the zero to negative green side a little bit, like maybe -8, -7. I don't like a super magenta look. That's just personal preference. And if I want to go back and see the baseline image, underneath your backspace key on Windows, I think on Mac too, it's the backslash button. If you hold it or press it, you can see what your image looked like before editing. And press it again and see what you did with editing so you can see the difference before and after. So I want to go through all of our sliders, the ones that I'm looking for right off the bat. So right off the bat, temperature, tint. Once I get these looks dialed in, I'm looking at exposure, correcting exposure, highlights and shadows get some work. And this is pretty extreme. I don't always go all the way back and all the way forward on highlights and exposure and shadows. Clarity, I like to play with this one. If you go low on it, it gets real fuzzy. That's not a great look. Clarity is not a super great way to stylistically make your things look soft or fuzzy. It kind of blurs colors into each other. It's not a great look to go too far back on clarity. And if you go too far forward, it gets this really contrasty, stark look. And I've actually incorporated it more into my editing as of late. I'll push it up to like 50 sometimes, depending on the photo. But it doesn't look great on like a woman's face per se, because it'll accentuate all the pores and harsh wrinkles and stuff. So be nice to your ladies when you photograph them and edit them. Vibrance, you can push this forward. This one's meant to push warm tones, so you can push like skin tones more vibrant. I usually pull back on it a little bit. I'm like around -10, -15, because I don't like a too saturated look. I rarely play with saturation because it can have a very harsh effect. I don't go too low with it or too high with it. I don't even play with it. I just kind of leave it there. Tone curve is where we start to get these stylistic looks. Maybe you've seen some of the more stylistic edits out there where people are doing all this wonky stuff to like how the tonality of the image. That's where you can play with it, is in tone curve. I'm gonna show an image where this can really take effect. So these are represent the tonality, the values of color in the image for hue. I can go in here and push my greens more and the yellows too green, and you can really change the look of an image here. I've been using this a lot lately to make our desertscape look more vivid. Sometimes our desertscape and floral and fauna looks a little brown and muddled. I like to push it kind of green. It's cheating, but I'll show you an image right here. All right away, I'm gonna bump this up on the exposure. And you'd probably say, tell me, Justin, you ruined that photo when you photographed it. If you shot this on a Canon camera, I wouldn't push 3 stops exposure. But on the Nikon stuff, I'm purposely shooting to preserve the highlights in the sky. And then I can do whatever I want with it in post. So I shoot underexposed now because I have my edit in mind when I'm going to do this. So I'm going to warm it up a little bit. And so this is what we had, and this is where we are. And I still got some detail left in the sky there. So now that's kind of brown. It's not really green. You can go in here to the yellow and green slider. Push this forward a little bit. Yeah, I wouldn't go too extreme with it. But look, now we've got a greener image now. And it doesn't look like Tucson anymore. And another
Would you do that if they were wearing something that had green, or?
I probably wouldn't, because then it would definitely affect it. You'd make them extra green, like Martian green. So yeah, it's definitely something you gotta look out for. There's another cool little tool here. It's this little clicker thing, adjust hue by dragging on the photo. I can click this and go over to a color I see and click and hold, And now if I push up on the mouse, I can adjust those. See that? So what I use right here, I'll undo it. I use this clicker right here. Click on that. Click on a color you see you want to change, and then you can push up or down on the mouse to change it. And yeah, I just do it for a little pop. I've actually created a preset for it, so I can go into an image and click on this and immediately bump up the greens a little bit. I'm taking creative license with our surroundings. Someone might say, I don't remember it being that green. Yeah, it wasn't that green. So, any questions so far? All right, so, and then you can also play with the saturation for each of these things. I can go in here and drop the yellow and the green all the way down, take saturation of it. I wouldn't do it all the way. You know, maybe I decide something's too vibrant. I could pull back on it just a little bit. Oh, and the other neat thing about that hue adjustment I was showing you earlier, say he was sunburned or he drank a lot before the session and was very red, you can click on that and click on that really red skin. This hue adjustment, it's here, right here, that little clicker. You click on that. I can click on his skin right now, and he's a little red. I can change the tone of his skin and make him really drunk, or I can push him the other way and take some of that redness out of his skin and make him a little more yellow. Now he's kind of jaundiced. He looks like he's been, he's got liver issues now. He's been drinking too hard. But if you undo it, you see how he a little flushed this in his color tones? You can subtly click on that, push forward, and correct it. So if you got a drunk uncle on wedding day who, yes?
Can you do that,
I have not been able to affect it otherwise. But if you're subtle enough with it, you can do a believable edit. Like, I don't know what else is red in this image that where I correct a little bit of pinkness in his tones. I can't even tell what I would have affected in the image. So it's all relative to the image. If you had a bunch of red in the background, like red balloons, and I pushed his skin a little more yellow, you might notice your red balloons went a little more orange. Yeah, I haven't figured out. Maybe that's a future feature coming. But these are just minor corrections I would do. Like that's a quick fix to someone who's got messed up skin on your wedding day. So all right, I keep saying wedding day because I shoot weddings, but
you can. Yeah, it's one of the newer updates.
Oh, really? Cool. Then I refuse to update Lightroom until they've worked out every kink, because I keep hearing it. They do an update, and then like 10, you know, 1,000 photographers are pissed off at Adobe for messing it up. All right, so the next thing I do is split. Okay, so yes, you can now. Split toning is another cool thing you can do. You can affect highlights or shadows. I don't know if any of you play with this, but this is where you can get really stylistic. In cinema, yellow highlights. Well, that's like green. Let me look at my screen here. Yellow in the highlights is kind of a look. You might, if you ever pay attention to movies, when they color grade, it's very popular to make your highlights very yellow. In some movies, it's stylistic, and it kind of gives a warm summer feeling. For a different look, they'll push blue into the shadows, and now we've got a different tonality to the image. So a couple things to play with. This is where you start messing with these looks. When you start playing with these features, you can now build your own preset and then later apply it to your images, and that might be your own look that you've developed. So these are where you can start playing with the creativity of editing. I feel like editing is a subjective thing. It's not. There is no right or wrong. Someone will show me an image, and I'm like, oh, I wouldn't do it that way. And another person will take that image and do something completely different with it. So have some creative liberty with it, some creative freedom with it. Take some liberties with it, but no. If you get too far deviated from the image, yeah, like it could look kind of crappy. It could be what's the word I'm looking for? It could be trendy or kind of kitschy. Like, you know, use it in moderation. I don't often play with these, and not for an engagement session. I have kind of a baseline look, and it's consistent for over the last 3 years. But if I were doing a stylistic model photo shoot, it might be something where I'd want to play with these tones and do something completely different from what I normally do. So I'm going to bring these down. So now we're back to what the image should look like. sharpening. I'm very quickly, I kind of have a baseline sharpening. I don't really play too much with the radius and detail. These are all here normally, but I'll zoom in and this is no sharpening. It's a little soft. I like to bring the sharpening up and I do a little bit of noise reduction, which reduces sharpness. But I do that kind of as a baseline because I may forget to play with the noise reduction on a high ISO image later, and I want a little bit of noise reduction. So I kind of live in this happy medium between sharpening and noise reduction, knowing that noise reduction will lessen some of the sharpness of the image. If I reduce that noise reduction, it's hard to see on this display, but there, these areas, the shadows, I can see a little more noise introduced even at low ISO. But if I bump the noise reduction up, it kind of cleaned it up a little bit and took away a negligible amount of sharpening. But very quickly, I do make sure my sharpening is, I'm around like 70 to 85. I feel like that's a good range to be in. The next one, this is more applicable in real estate. So Chris, you've done some real estate shooting. I don't know if it'll exhibit it well, these images. Let me open up a real estate photo real quick and I'll show you what these will do. And see how easily I navigated those folders. I knew immediately where to go to find a real estate shoot and quickly get into it. And I'm opening that catalog right away and I'm already here. And I'm sorry for everyone yawning. We're on the home stretch. No, you're not the only one I've seen. I'm like, am I boring everyone? I'm sorry. Okay, so here's a good example of how to use these lens correction tools. I'm going to reset this to baseline. So this is my unedited image. Lens correction. Right away, we have some easy options to correct perspective. If you're shooting real estate or you have like architecture in your images, you can click on vertical, and that quickly will try to align all the lines in a vertical fashion. You can turn that off. You can go full, and it'll enable full level horizontal and vertical perspective corrections. This one gets really wonky and does some crazy shit like that. So, which actually, if you crop, you can do constrained crop, and it'll do those adjustments within a crop. Yeah, it looks like crap. Turn it off. And now it resets your crop. So you have to. Go back to your baseline crop, otherwise it takes over on your crop. So auto works for a little perspective control. Vertical's good. These are ones I use a lot in real estate. You can go into manual and do this all by hand. So I like to do constrained crop so I don't see all the white areas that pop up. But if you don't, like you'll see if I change the vertical, see what it's doing? It's moving the bottom closer to the screen, closer to you, and pushing the top closer to you, depending on which way you adjust it. It's trying to correct perspective. So I would click on constrained crop, fix these vertical lines so they're all vertical. And you can also change, you can rotate. And some lenses, like wide angle lenses, will bow outward. It's like your fish eyes. You can change that and adjust for it here. So if you notice like your image is starting to bow outward, I can't remember what kind of distortion they call it, barrel distortion. Yeah, you can correct that here. So these are ones I use a lot for correcting perspective. I do it a lot in portraits too, where I notice I'd like to level the horizon. You can also crop that way too, but down here we're getting very pinpoint. You're getting a lot of pinpoint accuracy in making those corrections. I'm gonna go back to our other catalog, and you can go to file, open recent, and go back to the last catalog, and it'll open right away. So, you know, talking about those master catalog situations we were talking about before, where you have one catalog and, you know, it's probably easier to navigate. I don't really feel like it's an obstacle to my navigation of these images. I'm quickly back to our catalog that we were just at. I quickly got into that real estate shoot. Like, once you start navigating it and you have good file structure in place, you'll be able to do the same too. So it won't be this chore of like, oh, I got to open up this catalog now. Like, it just becomes part of the process. So. All right.
What's the idea of having individual catalogs on hard drives that are, you know, for 1 year at a time?
Yeah, that's the way to do it.
Instead of archives that are for a year at a time.
But should you move one shoot off that drive to another drive you want to work on, that's where you start to come into problems. That's where I'd rather have a shoot per catalog, a catalog per shoot. So, okay, so we're almost done with these. Post-crop vignetting and lens vignetting. Lens vignetting is where we correct, you know, some if we shoot wide open, it tends to darken the corners. Like if you shoot at like 2.8 on a 200 millimeter lens, your corners will be dark. You can push this the other way and brighten the corners up a little bit if you want to fix that. So mine's got a little vignetting in the corners. I'd push this a little bit just to fix those corners. The thing is, if we crop an image where we fix the lens vignetting or didn't fix it, for example, where we at here? Keep looking up. It affects the corners of the original image. If I want to do a vignette after the crop, I can now do post-crop vignetting. See what's happening here? I crop the image, and now we have new corners for the image. We use the post-crop vignette to adjust vignette or create one if we want to. That's just for like stylistically if you want to do that. If I were to play with the vignette right now, I would only affect the original corner that was the full image. If you go back, if I reset my, does that make sense? Yeah, so that's just something to consider if you're cropping images and playing with vignettes. I don't play with the vignette often. Effects. Oh, okay, you can add grain to your image if you want to have an old-timey look. I never do that. In fact, a lot of the Visco presets have it added. I take it out of all the presets that I ever use. I don't care for the grain look. I'm always trying to remove it, not add it. And there's also a new feature called Dehaze on CC, where if you had a foggy image, you can... Bless you. Say the image was foggy like this already from the get-go, you can now push this slider over to... adjust the haze, and you can actually bring, like, if you shot a foggy day and everything was really hazy, you could use this slider to correct that. All right, so down here is camera calibration. A lot of people like to push the blue primary saturation forward to get a different look here. So you see it, you can work at it from 50 to 100. It's hard to overdo this one unless there's a lot of blue lights in your images. If you shot like a nighttime image and there was like blue strobe lights going off, this slider can really get wonky. So you got to watch it. But on an outdoor image, if you push it all the way, it makes for a nice, tonal. Like I like what it does to an image. So you see that's no blue primary, and then that's 100%. So it's a nice way to add some vividness to your outdoor images. Instead of playing with your saturation slider, I would recommend the blue primary slider under calibration. It's the very last slider on this sheet here, on this panel here. So I'm going to show you one way to navigate these panels, and this is a huge bane of mine. I hate the panel system. I hate that I have to slide through all these and find each little thing I want to work with. I wish it was like Photoshop and I could move each of these little panels around and have them all accessible like you would. If you had a second monitor, I could have them out as palettes. But this is what we're stuck with. But there's another way you can navigate these. You can right-click here on one of the right-click or control-click on Apple, or and you can go here and click on solo mode. And now we only have open the ones we want to work on instead of seeing that one giant panel the way I had it. I don't like this mode either. I don't think it's a fix for wanting to see every panel open. I don't want any barrier to access. I just want to be able to get into it and start moving right around right away. So I don't work in solo mode, but you may like it because it might take away some of the clutter of seeing all of this open. I'll expand all now. This is how I work. I leave it open. I scroll through with my mouse wheel. It's faster for me. I hate it though. It's still not my favorite way to do it. Or you can work in solo mode. This might make it easier for you. Does anyone use solo mode or know about that? Yeah. So it's an easier way to navigate.
Scrolling through that is a pain.
It is, yeah, and I wish I wish Adobe would fix it, but they have not listened to anyone's complaints about it yet. All right, so we talked about collection. Okay, all right, so I want to teach everyone how to build a preset. So this is something you can do right now if you want to. I'm gonna reset this image real quick. And you can all do this along with me if you have an image up open on your computer right now. So we're gonna I'm gonna teach you how to make a look real quick. And if you like it, you can now make it into a preset. So right off the bat, and the things you want a preset for aren't like you don't want to you don't want to build expo because if you go over here to the left and go at the top of your presets, there's a little plus button here, create new preset. And you can name it whatever you like. And you can give it a, you can put it in a folder. And I if you're gonna make custom presets, make a new folder. If you want it to show up at the top of your list there, you know, give it a number or something like 01 and call it, I'll call it Lightroom Lite presets.
How did you get the new developed presets?
On the left here, you see presets on your left column? There's a plus button there.
Oh, here?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, so you can make your own presets, and this is if you if let's see, I feel like I should explain one thing beforehand. Okay, so you can image to image, I can click on an image and go to the and do a bunch of edits to it and go to the next image, and there's one way to quickly and one button quickly copy the previous settings to this image because they might be similar. Click on that previous button right there. It doesn't take you back. It actually copies over the settings from this last image, which it didn't work for this image because I overexposed it too much. But I can everything else probably will remain the same. I can bring that exposure down. And now this image has the characteristics of the last image with a corrected exposure. This is how we start to build consistency in our editing style. How many people here feel like you have a style? Yeah, or how many feel like you're still, yeah, most of us probably in the, yeah. And style is something that always changes, but you might have a style, but do you have consistency? You know, that's one thing that we all struggle with is consistency. And it took me a better part of a year to be like, oh, I have a style here. I've been doing this all the same for all the this whole time. So,
what was that previous button?
Oh, it's right here, previous on the right here, right there. Is that still recording, or is it dead?
It says card full.
Oh, all right, never mind. It's like shut up, Justin. You've been talking too long. Previous is a one-button application of the previous image's settings to the next file. The other thing you can do is you can copy the settings from this, and maybe I don't want to copy. Okay, so we went back here. If I went here and I hit copy, and I kept the exposure as part of the copy settings, and I go to this image now and I paste it, I just blew out the exposure because I'm using the last image was underexposed. This image was fine. So I can go back here. And let's see. I'll undo that real quick. Sorry. Where are we at? Okay. I can go back to that image and I want to copy everything about this image except for exposure. Uncheck exposure. Hit copy. Go here. And now hit paste. And I pasted the characteristics of the last image, but I did not paste the exposure characteristics. So it absorbed all of the style of the last image without accepting that overexposed. It would have been up here if I had copied it over exactly verbatim. So that's another nuance you can get a hold of. Like you don't want to build your presets with exposure because you might build it's not universal that way. Then you may have built a preset and you had your image your exposure at +2 and now suddenly when you apply that preset to all your images they're all overexposed because only one image was underexposed. So when you build a preset or copy settings, it's not wise to play with exposure unless I had 5 images in a row and they're all very similarly shot. So I'm just trying to get your head wrapped around the notion of like what settings you want to copy over or why what you want to build a preset with. So I'm going to undo that. Here, I could go ahead, maybe just for convenience, I could hit previous and see how, okay, so I saw a little change here and now I need to bump up the exposure. And man, I'll be damned if that's not already close to what I was hoping for. And I didn't have to spend any time with it. In fact, I would just zoom in. You know, he's a little pink, whatever. I might bring down his shirt a little bit because it's kind of bright. Maybe a little white here. Really, really though, and she's a little dark. I could bump the shadows up just a little bit on her. But I think that's pretty close to what I was hoping for right there. I don't have to play with that anymore. Maybe I'd copy over the previous image settings from that to this. Pretty spot on right there. I'm happy with that image. So what I'm trying to do is limit my time working with each image. If my baseline aesthetic and feel is close enough, image to image, I'm going to go previous again, apply the last image of settings. Wow, I didn't even have to play with the exposure on this one. That's pretty spot on right there. Next image. Previous image settings. Overexposed because we were under on the last image. I just got to pull back that exposure a little bit. I would say for these six images, I just nailed six looks within minutes, and I didn't have to do a lot to get there. I got a base preset. I've got some minor slider adjustments. Really, you should be playing with exposure, highlights, and shadows, and make sure you're. And if you're going, you know, if you're copying settings over to each image, my presets are built with these baseline sharpening and noise reduction. So I don't even play with this. So really, most of my heavy lifting, image to image, is done with the exposure slider, the highlights, and the shadows. Contrast, I don't like to get it too high, but you know, I'm anywhere from 0 to 30 on the contrast, depending on how I feel about the punch of an image. So six images, all with the same aesthetic feel and stylistic considerations. And all I had to do was play with exposure, really. I mean, does that make sense to everyone? Is that something you think you could apply to your own images now that you've seen it in place? So when you start working with your presets that you have, your Mastin or the Gatsby one you're talking about, or SLR Lounge, think of them as a starting point. Find a way to apply to all your images, and then if you're looking at your, all you should be looking at next is three sliders, really: exposure, highlights, and shadows. And you can get through a whole set of images much quicker this way. And I really just want to get the images out as quickly as possible. So those are the baseline things that I'm looking for. So any questions? Is this the fun stuff? Is this the stuff we really care about when we're editing an image? All the other stuff sucks, right? All the catalog management and the file. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's necessary, but all I want is that, and I know it took the longest part of the presentation, but all I want is that you can get through that part so quickly that we're immediately getting to this part, and the next part's going to be easy. Now we're done. Like, the next part we're looking at is exporting these images. But Aman, I want to touch on your local adjustments real quick. We've got local adjustments, radial adjustments, and graduated adjustments. Does everybody have an understanding of what those tools are? These are our ways to touch upon parts of an image and give an adjustment to it selectively. So here is this image. We've got these dark shadows here from the trees. It's underexposed. We have our radial adjustment, and this is an adjustment that you can make here. You can make this round circular adjustment. You can change the dimensions of it. And now I can go in here and I can change exposure values or any of these sliders. I can change them for all the areas outside of this circle. And you can feather this so it encroaches upon them. If I take that feather away, that's a hard line that you would never do that. You click on it, you know, maybe I'd want a softer feather, and it starts to encroach upon them a little bit. And this is a harsh adjustment. I just want to show you how extreme your adjustments can be. But you can bring it down just a little bit, you know. But what I actually wanted to do was correct it. So I want to push the other direction. I want to push these this a little bit, and maybe I want to bump these shadows up a little bit. Let's see, I want to bump those shadows up a little bit. Push the blacks a little bit. Nope, if I push the blacks, it starts to wash them out. That's not a good look. So that's why I never really play with that. And so, you know, I don't necessarily think I had to correct those, but if I wanted to, you know, a radial adjustment, that fits in that space very well. You know, it's a circular opening leading to them. And when you feather it nicely, it's believable. Like, if I'm gonna delete this real quick, so it's gone. And now I'm gonna undo that. You're gonna see its effect take effect again. Is that completely unbelievable, or does that pass the eye test? Like, that's how it looked when I shot it. My goal when I edit is I'm taking our creative license, and I am trying to do things to the images that are not completely unbelievable. Like, you know, I'd like to think there's some art in this still, and that when I do that to an image, I'm not making such an unbelievable image. I'm just augmenting the reality somewhat. They don't know what I saw when I looked through the camera. They don't know what my raw files are looking like. This is me getting to pass off reality as believable. You know, I'm taking some liberties with it. But yeah, maybe I wouldn't even bother. It's probably fine just like that. I'm overthinking it. Now, this image, for example, I wanted to get in here, and she is very dark. And maybe I can go in here 2:1. So I can zoom in even more. This is 200% zoom. We're looking for the local adjustment brush. That's that right there. You can hit K on your keyboard, or you can click it here. And now I want to, and you can scroll with your mouse wheel to make it bigger or smaller. And notice that it's also feathered. You can change the feathering of it. I can have a very hard line cut off, or I can push it a little bit and soften the effect of the impact of it. But what I would like to do right now is I want to bump her face up a little bit. So I'm going to give a little bit of exposure here and a little bit of shadow bump. And I want to selectively paint in her face just a little bit. And maybe even a little bit under her hair, just the hair right there. And that highlight might be a little too harsh. But this is where we start to have to do
some negotiation with ourselves. What are we willing to accept in terms of believability of that image? So that's a local adjustment. I'm going to undo it. So now it's gone. But now I bring it back. And when I zoom back out, you know, earlier, that's that. Now, you know, now you can't even see her face right now. It's better on my screen, but if I undo, if I bring that back in, it filled her in a little bit. That's still believable. Like, no one's going to be like, well, that should be dark because the sun is to her right, and naturally her face would be dark. Well, you know, whatever. Sue me. Like, I feel good.
Bouncing off of his shirt.
Sure, that's a believable lighting situation. Yeah, exactly. Good point. No one's going to look at this image and try to tell me technically, well, that doesn't make sense. She should be way underexposed in her face. Like, no, jerk. I brushed her up in Lightroom and gave her a little, yeah. So, but my objective is to be subtle about it. I mean, if I went in here and I was like a, you know, and I really like bump these shadows up all, actually, it doesn't even look bad. You know, here we go. Let's make her the same exposure as him. That doesn't look right at all, you know? That's not believable. But if I pull back on it and I'm subtle about those adjustments, it's an improvement, it's believable, and you know, I get a little more, it's something to this image. So local adjustments are how we can touch up things that we want to affect individually. Where we, in Photoshop, we would use the dodge and burn tool. In Lightroom, we use a local adjustment tool, and we play with the exposure, highlights, and shadows. So that's one way to correct something underexposed locally versus using it in Photoshop where we're doing dodging and burning. So there's also a graduated filter, and this is like a hard line. Like you can soften the effect. I'm gonna turn this exposure down. You can flip it around. You can stretch it and soften some of the effect of that. This is good for landscape people. If you got a horizon line and it's a very, very clearly defined horizon line, you could do this with it. Where we would have shot with a graduated neutral density filter in landscape and had the horizon a little more darker or orange, like that's a thing in landscape photography. You don't really have to do that anymore. You could just do it in Lightroom. So say I wanted to bring this over here and I decided that's where I want it to be dark. There's a cool new feature on Lightroom CC where we can go here and now this is a graduated filter. There's a brush option. And you can go down here and click on erase, or right now it's defaulted to add locally to that graduated adjustment. But I've brought that adjustment over their faces. She's now darker than she should have been. I can come in here and erase now, and I can zoom in. Oh, let me go. And I can now erase inside of that graduated filter. and selectively remove where it was affecting because it was getting too carried away. And if I really want to get in here, I could erase it off her face and. You know, and the more you feather things, the more believable they tend to be. If there's a softer drop off, it's not so obvious that you went in here and did this. So this is my way of bringing back some of the exposure that I brought down when I brought in that graduated filter. And we're in the home stretch here. So now you see my graduated filter right here, but I erased where they are. So if I keep moving this into the image more, they still remain. See, now you see where I didn't erase that mask. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. So this is a way to do a bigger, more sweeping adjustment. You could do this with the radial adjustment too. If I'd gone in here and did a radial adjustment, and this is one that I do pretty often because I like to bring focus to a couple in a scene like this where they're pretty bright. I'll do a radial adjustment around them. I will bring the exposure down a little bit. A little bit of the highlights. I'll bring it down just subtly like that. And I will bring this inside of them just a little bit. And now they're starting to get a little darker here because that radial adjustment is affecting them. But I will selectively erase some of that adjustment that's affecting them now. Because I only want it to be in the background. See, it's brightening up now. And now, when I pull back on this image, we have a new dynamic to this image. That radial filter that I use to lower this exposure down a little bit, it's pretty believable. I can remove that now. That's what our image looked like. This is what I made it look like. You may or may not like that, though. That might be too, like, oh, you're playing with reality there. But, I mean, we're artists, right? I think we're artists. Or we're documentarians, however you want to do this. Maybe it's too much. Maybe I should not do it so strongly. And I can now. So that's what it was. This is what it could be. You know, like it or love it. I don't know. How do you feel about that? Is that something believable? Do you think your clients will notice? Or do you think, like, holy, your clients might look at it and think, holy crap, you made that scene look awesome. I don't remember it that way. So, oh, and here I can go in here and do our green boost again. Boom. I don't know of any deserts that look like that, but all right. So home stretch, because I want to get you to the export. Oh, so our presets real quick. So now I got this look built. You can go in here, create a new preset, give it its own folder, give it a name. We'll call this one Warmy Schwarmy, and we have a basic. And I don't remember. I don't want to play with exposure in there because that could be wonky. We're at +2 exposure right now. If I build this preset and I go to a very bright image and apply the preset, it'll blow it out even further. So don't mess with the exposure. We can keep the contrast. I'd say my highlights and shadows are pushed a little too hard here, but I'll keep that all in here. Tone curve is important. Clarity, sharpening. Our color treatment, I played with the colors a little bit, especially if I do that green boost. Lens corrections, I don't want to play with that. I try to do the ones that apply style and don't mess with local adjustments. You would never want to do graduated filters or radial filters typically because if I had done that, this radial adjustment I did here, if I go to another image and they're now on the right side of the frame and I apply the preset with that radial filter, it's going to miss its mark completely. So I wouldn't bother doing that with my preset. I wouldn't build it in there. So this is most of our look right here. I'm going to create it. And so now we have a preset built. I could do another one where I go down here and I play with the split tones and I gave this, where's the split tones at? Sorry. This is why I hate this menu. I have to scroll through it all. Color, black and white, no color. Split toning, okay. I might want to make this image have blue shadow tones and yellow highlights. And now that's a different look. And now I make this preset a new preset and I call this one cinema tones. So now we've created that. Now I go back to one of my old image, another image, and I click on the cinema tones preset. And now we change the look of that image. I just built my own preset and I applied it to another image. You can do it too. So that's where, you know, if you start to get a look and a style down, you can make your own presets and start applying them to your images. And, you know, I could apply this look to all the images now. I can go in, I mean, I could copy it all the way across. Let's give this one, let's try that look again, cinema tones. What do you think? And so this is where the virtual copies feature comes in handy. Right click the image, go to create virtual copy, and all this is doing is creating another set of instructions to do to the raw file upon export. So we have, it's not creating another raw file, it's just creating another image in the catalog corresponding to that raw file. So I can go here now, make this one a black and white image. And so now I have a black and white copy and a color copy of that image. So virtual copies are a no-risk way of trying out different looks on your images. Maybe I want to try a different image look on the same image. Now I've got a third virtual copy. I can go in here, try that green boost. So now we've got three different looking images. So this is a way to start playing with variety and options and exploring different looks with your images. You can create a virtual copy and not have to worry about losing a previous image to try a new thing out. So if you want to take your editing in a different style, play with virtual copies. All right.
So is there a way to, if you want to add your watermark to these individual images?
Yep. And that's the last part. We're on export now, and I'm going to make this our shortest part of the discussion. So this is where we go to the export module. So now we've finished all these images. Control A, I've got all these images selected. I want to export all these. So now we go to File, go to Export. And I've built presets for my exports because there's a few things I do I do often. So one of the things I do often when I export my images is I export for Facebook. So I've got a preset built for exporting my images optimized for Facebook with my watermark. I'm not sure where my watermark file is located, but we're gonna figure this out. So I wanna help, does anyone have a watermark here? Everyone got a logo or anything that they are working with on their images? Have you figured out a way to show it on your photos? Are you just going into Photoshop and adding it and then saving it?
Lightroom.
Yep.
The only thing I don't like about Lightroom is you can't put it exactly where you want. Or at least I don't know how.
Okay, I will show you that. So, okay. I want to leave here making you guys two or three presets, and I'll explain the presets that I have for export. I've got a JPEG preset for Facebook with my watermark. It's no bigger than 1200 pixels, and it's optimized for sharing on Facebook. The file sizes are very low, small, so that's one preset we're going to make. The other preset we're going to make is my deliverable to my clients is I don't give them full-size JPEGs. They don't need them. They don't know what to do with them. They go to Walgreens. They do shitty things with my pictures. I hate it. So I give them printable files no larger than 8 by 12 inches. I've capped it off at the resolution that is equivalent to 8 by 12 inches. If they start printing bigger than that, they're going to lose quality. The images are going to start to pixelate. They try to print a 20 by 30 off my 8 by 12 file. It's not going to look as good as if they had printed with me. And the last thing I do is a full-size, 100% quality image with no size resizing. I leave it full-size because I might want to run a 20 by 30. That's going to be saved on my Zenfolio account later. It's my if all hell breaks loose backup copy that I put on the internet. So I want to build these three presets for you so you can start using them. So next time you edit your photos, you can export to Facebook right away because you want to share these images. And then, oh, your client wants their finished images. Well, maybe you should start giving them an 8x12 printable file only too. Well, you're going to have some clients that want a full-size image as well. So you got to make those choices. But those are the three sizes I use the most. And if you agree with that, it might be a deliverable you start giving your clients. It's easy for me to put 8x12 printable files on a zip file and uploading it to Dropbox and sharing it with my clients. I don't have to deliver them a disk. I don't have to give them a USB thumb drive. But I actually don't even give 8x12 print-ready files to my engagement or family sessions. All my little sessions, all they ever see is a Facebook watermarked image with my logo on it. And if they want to order prints, they got to order it through my Zenfolio account. I've taken away full-size images from people because they just don't know what to do with them. They're not, if they're going to print, they should use my vendors and they can trust the quality of the products that I can deliver them. If they go print at Walgreens, it just doesn't look good. So if you have been struggling with your pricing and what people want from you and what to give them, and you're at a, you know, most of us have a job already and the work we do with photography is low risk. Like we're not counting on, if you're not counting on that for your paycheck, there's no sense in just giving away the work to someone who may not respect or take care of it the way you would. So you could take away the full size images from your clients. They won't know the difference. Give them a website quality image and tell them that they can only order prints from you. And now you start to take possession of those images again. In the film days, they didn't have this problem. No one handed over, well, some people did. No one handed over negatives for their images. Us handing away the raw files, we would never do that. But sometimes people ask for it. So I didn't mean to get into a philosophical conversation about what we should be doing, giving our clients, but I don't see any reason why my family photo shoots and my engagement sessions need anything more than a website's image to share on Facebook, because that's what they want to do anyway. So.
Well, huge thank you for saying that, because I do come from the film days, and it's been a really hard transition. Mm-hmm. Thing. It's like, I've got all these files, I just want to go here.
Yeah.
After hours and hours of work, that helps to think, like, it's okay to give them an 8x10 size file.
Sure. And my wedding clients, they really want to think they have possession of these files. Like, I got to have those full size files. I'm like, why? I'm like, are you a graphic designer? Or are you a printer? I actually did have a printer talk to me about her wedding the other day. She's like, yeah, actually I do. I work at Graphic Impact. I'm like, okay, fine. But so yeah, I would like for photographers to be able to retain some of the creative license with what we're doing with these finished files. People don't need them like they think they do. Yeah, so give them a website file. Tell them they can order prints on your website if you've got a web portal set up for buying images. You can do that. Like, you know, if you lead them, if they think they want to buy prints, then show them where they can buy prints. You can take possession of the print workflow. So real quick, I'm going to help you make these presets real quick and show you how to do a watermark. The first one we're going to start with, and you can all do this with me. So disregard everything on the left side of the screen. We're only going to start here on the right. Our export location. So this is where we want to see our folder, our images, where they're going to end up when we export them. A lot of you might be just exporting them into one big folder on your computer. If you're doing that, we're going to change that right now. So we want to export to the same folder as the original photo. Where was our original photo? It's in the Naomi and Mike eSession folder. And so if you start doing this where you are creating one catalog per folder of images and you export in the same folder as the original photo, you will always know where to find your finished JPEG file. It'll be with your RAW files. So do it this way. No ifs, ands, or buts. So same folder.
You don't create a subfolder?
Yes. Yep, I will put it in a subfolder, in the same folder as the original folder. I call mine websites. You can call it Facebook. You can call it web optimized. Give it any name you want, but something to delineate, to differentiate between it and the full size, the bigger size images. So put it, sorry, I know it's hard to read. Put it, you can come look over here if it's helpful. Yeah. Put it in a subfolder in the same folder as original photo. I'll call this one Facebook just for the heck of it. Don't worry about add to this catalog. If you do that, everything you export, you make a folder of JPEGs, will now be a part of this catalog, and now you'll start seeing duplicates of your images and wonder what the hell you're doing, so don't do that. If there are existing files, like say you did this process more than once and you had the same file names, it'll say, hey, you've got these folder names, image names with the same in the same folder. What do you want to do? I always like it to ask me what to do instead of overwriting them or not doing the process at all. So I have it set to that. File name. I think that the easiest way to do this, click on rename to, give it a custom name and a sequence. So the custom text will be whatever you want to name it to, Naomi, Mike, eSession. And I get elaborate on these because I want the customer to know when they got my websites files that they're looking at websites file. So I'll say websites do not print. And I don't care that I have 100 images that say do not print on them. That's their indicator to them. You don't have to do it that way, but you know, some indication, hey, this is websites images. I can be that descriptive with the file name. Starting number one, because I'm starting from the beginning. So you don't have to fill that in right now, of course. So keep it set to rename to and custom name sequence. The next setting is file settings. Our image format is JPEG. That's what we're going to export to because that's what we can universally share easily. Some people want to do a PSD or a TIFF file if you're working with a few images and you want maximum quality. TIFF files, you're rarely going to ever need to work in a TIFF file. 100% JPEG will probably be more than you'll ever need. But this is where we start looking at someone who's might be doing really like high-end commercial retouching or artistic stuff. Don't worry about it. Stick to JPEG. For our web quality, I've learned that 80 is the magic number. We had Nathan Holritz here from Photographer's Edit a few months ago who told us 80, that they could print 20 by 30 inch prints off their max size JPEGs at 80% quality and not notice any discernible drop off in quality. 80 is the magic number. So I think for web, make it 80. I am neurotic. I'll go to 90 to 100 on my full size JPEGs, but on web, 80 is fine. I'm like 83 just for peace of mind. Color space, if you're doing...
Quality print?
No, this is for web.
Well, what do you put that at if
I'm doing print?
Yeah.
I'll keep it around, like, on my 8x12 print ready files, I'll give them 85 to 92 in that range. Okay. On my full-size JPEGs that I want as my forever backup, I go 100 just because I can. My web cloud backup is 100% is unlimited storage, so I don't care how big my files are. But they do take a long time to upload. I do it overnight. So resized, okay, so JPEG and then color space, sRGB. That is our color space for our monitors and most of our displays. Even printers, if you bring them an sRGB image, they can print from that. They tend to be optimized to convert sRGB images into their color workflow. So for anything web, sRGB is fine. Quality, I said 82, so leave it there. I don't ever do limit file size too. That could get pretty wonky. I wouldn't play with that. Image sizing. I want to select resize to fit. We want to set it for the longest dimension because an image can be vertical or it can be horizontal. So we want Lightroom to detect the longest edge and resize the image to the longest edge. I have it set to 1200 pixels. That's what I have it set to. You could go bigger or smaller. I used to do 900 for Facebook. Right now I'm at 1200. If I told it the shortest edge, it would now take the, you know, if it was a vertical image, it'd be the top and bottom it would be looking for, and it would change the image to the shortest edge at 1200 pixels, and your longer edge would be much longer than that. So we want to stick to longest edge, 1200. Resolution for displays, this doesn't even matter anymore, but I'm old school. I've always learned your monitor display is 72 dpi pixels per inch, so leave it at 72 for my peace of mind, not yours. Sharpen for screen. I like to do it a little bit and a standard amount. Just I like the image to have a little more punch for the screen. I don't do that feature on the print options. I leave it unchecked. Thanks for coming through, Micah.
Can you do some sharpen for what now?
Sharpen for screen. Amount standard. Metadata, you can remove your metadata if you want, so that way no one can right-click your image and see what you did. I don't care. I do whatever you want there. Watermark. So this is where we make our watermark. We click on watermark here to turn it on, and you go into edit watermark. And a new window pops up. And we can now choose an image for our watermark. I have no idea where my file is. I think I can find it. Here it is. Watermark, email, new, this one. So now I see my watermark on here, and I can actually change the opacity of it. I can change the size of it. And I can change the location of it. I like to keep mine in the bottom right corner. If I had a different logo, a square logo, maybe I'd have it in the center. I think bottom right.
Depending on what you're shooting, With the images, you might want to move the work.
Right? 1,000 images. I will never want to nitpick placement of that watermark. I just export it. There might be something important in the bottom right corner of the frame. It's negligible for how small my watermark is. I just kind of live with it. If I wanted to go back, I could fix it, sure. But I won't. I will never want to go and pinpoint which images have a problem with my watermark. It's just too much work. Yeah. So I want to minimize my time in and out of Lightroom. So yeah. So maybe like that big. You get a feel for the proportion of it and where you have it. You can even rotate it around if you want to play with it that way.
So now, as far as your watermark color, do you keep it the same color regardless of what it is?
Yep. Yep.
He's got a white background.
Yeah. I've added a white background, so my logo will show on whatever I put it in front of. There are a lot of ways to do this. Some people don't have that white background on there, and they're just going off the text alone. I struggle with that. I may have a logo redesign at some point too. I've made it easy for myself. It'll show up on anything I put it on, but some people may not have that luxury. So you might need an alternate logo color. And I would hate to have to figure out, okay, this set of images has to be my white logo, this one has to be my black logo. That's a whole lot of work to go through for putting a watermark in an image. In which case, I will tell you, don't watermark your image. Just put it out there. If they really want to know who did it, they'll ask. And you might risk someone taking your image on Facebook, but you know, what does that mean to you? So some people are in the camp that don't watermark your images at all. If it really mattered, somebody will find you, you know. Somebody will ask, oh, who shot your wedding? Well, Justin shot it, you know. So, yeah, it's something to work with. And you can add a text watermark. You can go in here and just do text like that, which looks ugly. But anyway, so this is how we build a watermark. Now we can go in here and we can save current presets as current settings as a new preset. And we'll call this one Lightroom Lite Watermark. And so now I'm done. When I go here to watermark, I can click on that and select the watermark I want. And the last setting, after export, I put show in Explorer. On Mac, you'll say show in Finder. So that way, when this is done processing, it will open up the window and show me the finished files. And before I do that, I want you all to click on add. And we're gonna name this preset Facebook export. Or whatever you want to call it, websites export, create. So now, next time I come to this window, I will click on Facebook export for these images, and I will immediately have all these settings queued up, and all I got to do is put in a file name and hit export. So, boom. If your computer is relatively fast, you know, you'll get those images pretty quick. You can run more than one process side by side. So I mentioned the next one we're going to build is the 8x12 setting, and then our last one will be the full size JPEG. And I'll show you, you can run all three simultaneously. It's very easy to do. And that's when I walk away from the computer and go have a beer, because I've spent 12 hours on a wedding and I'm over it. So here it is. It opened up this is now in my eSessions folder in Naomi and Mike. Unfortunately, because it's in the pics folder. So I actually recommend don't do a pics folder, just make a toss folder and put all your images into the toss and leave your pics here in the main folder. But so now in the pics folder, we have a folder called Facebook with our finished JPEGs. And so now they're all watermarked, ready to be uploaded, optimized for Facebook. And you saw earlier we did that virtual copy. Three copies of the image, three different looks. So that's how we start playing with virtual copies and do our black and whites. So I do a segment of images from my wedding, black and white, all my artistic moments that I want to make. All right, last one. We do these last two things and we're out of here. So thank you all for hanging in here with me. All right, so the last one is, so we're going to go, the last two, export. So we're going to do this again. So this is our new one for 8x12. And we're going to make this subfolder, we'll call it 8x12 client print. Everything else can kind of stay the same. We'll remove the custom text. JPEG, color space. I like to go Adobe RGB for print because this is a bigger color space and you won't lose colors that you worked on. It doesn't matter though, just stick to sRGB. I don't want to confuse anyone. The printer can work with your files. You should get consistent results with what you see on your computer. to what you print. Quality, I don't care if these files have 100 quality, I'll keep them at like 80, keep them at 85. Your clients will get an 85 quality. It'll print fine at 8x12. Now we're gonna resize these to, I don't know the exact pixel dimension that represents 8x12. So I wanna change our longest edge to 12 inches. At 300 DPI, that's our print resolution. I know this number doesn't mean anything, I've come to learn, but in the old print days, digital graphic design days, that mattered. So, resize to fit, long edge, 12 inches. You can click on that dropdown, go from pixels to inches, 12 inches, resolution 300. Unclick sharpen 4. And then we'll unclick our watermark. And this is our, and now we'll create a preset for it. This is our 8x12 client print file. This is for the whiny ones who really want to file the print. You give them this. You tell them to go to Walgreens and eat their heart out. And so now, I'm going to make one more preset. I'm going to show you we can simultaneously export, and then we're done. So this one is going to go into a subfolder, and we're going to call it full size copy images. You can call whatever you want. And now all I got to do is I want to make this 100% quality JPEG, and we're not going to resize to fit. It's just going to export at its full size that the raw file is. So if you got a 24 megapixel or a 36 megapixel image, it's coming out its max resolution here. I don't got to do anything else. I'm going to add this, call it full shebang or size. Call whatever you want, and create that. So now I have 8x12 client print preset, Facebook export, and full shebang. These are my three main export presets now. I probably use the Facebook export the most. That's what I want to get my files out quickly. So right now I'm going to go full shebang. I need to back these files up. These are going to get uploaded to my Zenfolio account, so it's exporting right now. And I'm going to do the client Facebook export, or I'm sorry, 8x12 client print. And I got to make sure I give a name too. Export, and I'm going to export my Facebook size ones too while I'm at it. So all three export processes are at the same time. Walk away from your computer, come back. You're going to have three windows open. Those are your finished files. So you now get a file to get your client, a file to on Facebook, and a file to back up on your online web storage, which I highly recommend. Have an online resting place for all your images just in case anything ever happens to your hard drives. And it's going to be right now. You can see the progress. You see three progress bars here. You can actually check the three processes. You can cancel each one if you want to.
That makes sense.
Yep.
Because I had my Facebook files on my hard drive someplace else, and going back to it, that makes it much easier.
And I'll show you where they all end up. It's going to be done here in a second. I thank you all for hanging in here with me. This was a growing experience for me, so I hope you guys saw the transformation from when I went from could not get my words out to like, okay, I know what I'm talking about. Oh, I was so nervous.
You did great.
Thank you. And I don't know what it's like to sit here and have all this information be bombarded at you. It's a lot of stuff to cover, especially if you're not, I know we're not all techie, and.
No, you did great.
Okay, so look at that. We've got, I'm gonna close these all out. All of them are done. I'm gonna close Lightroom, I'm gonna close Bridge. So I'm going to close this all out. I'm going to go back to my folder. I'm going to go to photo 5. That's my hard drive. E-Sessions, Naomi and Mike. In the pics folder, I've got three folders now. 8x12 client print, Facebook, and full-size copy images. I know exactly what those three folders mean. I've got the same structure going for everything I've photographed for the last 3 years. So if I go through any of these, they'll have similar folder structures. Full size for Zenfolio, for web sharing, do not print, print ready 8x12s. Every client, every job, I know what I'm doing with those files. So, so if you ask me to go find a photo shoot from 3 years ago that I did for such and such client, I know which hard drive to go grab, and I know where to find the finished JPEGs, all from good structure. That's why the one master catalog seems like that's a great idea, because then I'll see it all in my Lightroom catalog. But if you have good back-end structure for all this from the get-go, you should always know where your files are at. So it's just a matter of categorization, organization on your hard drives, and consistency in your export. So that's it. Anyone have any questions? All right.
Do you work at all going back and forth between Photoshop and Lightroom?
That was something I wanted to touch upon, and I had to kind of get to an ending here because I feel like I've kept you guys too long. You can work in Photoshop through Lightroom and manage those PSD files from your catalog. I'll show you real quick. I promise this is not going to take long if you want to stay for this. Thanks for coming through, Gina.
I use a Nick collection to do a lot of my stuff.
Yeah. All right, so right click the image, and in your developer module, go to Edit In, and now edit in Adobe Photoshop CC 2015, or whatever version of Photoshop you're running. It'll now take all those adjustments that have been done to that RAW file and open up a version of that process RAW in Photoshop, full size. It's now a PSD file. After you get past the welcome message. Reading camera raw format. So it's reading all those instructions that Lightroom did to it. And so that's my raw file and as a PSD file now. So now I can go in here real quick and maybe I do some spot adjustments because someone's got some bad skin. So I can zoom in here and I'm actually working on the layer now and I'm cleaning him up. And I do these things to them. And I make a new layer, and I copy some things around.
He's way
hotter now. And so now, you know, I do these things. I made these layers now. And now I'm done with it, and I hit save, control S. And I'm just showing this little, I did this little thing here as an example. So I'm going to save this. Okay, it's already saving. So 40, 50, 100%. Okay, and I'm going to close it now. And I'm going to go back to Lightroom. Now we've added this PSD file to this catalog all by going edit in Photoshop. So now we have it in Photoshop and here in the Lightroom.
One more. You know what? With that, it doesn't shuffle it back in order, is what I've noticed. Unless there's a trick.
Yeah,
it puts it all the way at the end.
It puts it at the end of the.
Yeah.
Well, right. All it's done right now is put it at the end of this section of images. So it's still within. It's still within its relative area of the catalog.
How do you get it from doing that? Because mine does that too.
Yeah. I mean, I organize it at the end.
It's going to be the last one.
Yeah. Well, what I end up doing is at the end of all this, I actually don't think I'll work with that file RAW anymore. I delete the original RAW sometimes and just leave the PSD tucked into my catalog. So
maybe because of the filters?
No, it adopts the filtering, the rating system that I gave the other images, so it has all that. So I'm not sure. I've just come to accept it as part of how it functions when you work with it. Well, all I want to know is that I can still see it, and I can right-click it and go edit in Photoshop again, and that'll ask me, do you want to edit a copy with – because I can now do Lightroom adjustments to this and change it all over again. But what I do is when I go edit in, I can go edit in Photoshop, and I can edit a copy of this, a copy with those adjustments I made in Lightroom, or edit the original. You do edit the original, and it will open that PSD file again. I'm back to playing with this file again. So that's how I manage working with PSD files instead of from Photoshop in Lightroom.
It's probably the file name. It's because it's a PSD file that it puts it all the way at the end.
Yes, it's probably because it's .psd instead of .nef.
Yeah. If it's not a PSD file, it still does it. It's fine.
Thank you so much for coming. I'll be in touch on email. I'd love to hear feedback from everyone, good or bad. So thank you.
I'd do it again.
Awesome. Really great. Okay, that's good to know, because I want to expand on this, and gosh, I don't know what the cutoff time is. I feel like 2 hours is a good amount of time with this, but there's a lot of little nuances. I'd love to Q&A more with you guys. So, thank you so much for coming. All right, so that, yeah, I guess it probably is a file name thing. I'm going to not save that. I'm trying to think the best way to do it. Okay, so you can also do, if you wanted to and you didn't like where it's at, you could select all these images and create a quick collection. You could stack them. Yeah, or you go to, I'll drag them to a quick collection real quick. I think, yeah, 9 images here. Quick collection. And now I'm looking at them in sequence. The PSD file was that last one. I can now do custom order. I can move it and put it at the front of that stack. And now I can look at my own custom order that I've created. So that's one way to manage the order of all this.
Yeah,
so
it's just when you're doing like a wedding, it sticks it all the way at the back.
Are you meaning like the end of the entire catalog?
Yes.
I've never had that happen, so I'm not sure why it's doing that. It might be how if.
It bugs me.
It might be your file. It might be down here though. Check down here your sort and go to, you can either do capture time, added order. It might be because it's added order.
Oh,
if you're at added order, it'll bump it. Yeah, it'll bump it all the way to the end and added order.
What was it?
But if you do it on capture time.
If you do it on capture time, it'll slot it where it was from.
That was right-click on that?
If you just click it, and you go to added order, and it did. It does pop it all the way at the end. See, I think it defaults to added order. So you could probably fix that. Go to capture time, but I always end up doing a custom custom organization of everything anyway, so. Right here, go to your library module, and I'm in grid mode, and I'm down here at the bottom, it's to the right of your, it's down here, added order. You can click here.
Yeah,
you can
go up.
I mean, I've been working with it like that for a while.
Yeah.
So it's like, I'm used to it, but that's good to know.
Yeah, that would, you're right, that would annoy me. I guess I don't know, I'm always playing with these sort orders, so. Yeah, gosh, there's a lot of stuff I would have loved to get into with you guys, but I feel like this is a good wrap-up point here. So to wrap this all up, all I'm looking for is to help you guys establish a quick get in and get out. So, you know, start by moving your images into a folder. That's the quickest thing you can do, the safest way to get your files in. You could have created a new catalog, imported those folders. You could do it that way, sure. But all I'm trying to do is get those images onto my hard drive. I'm not often working on those images till later anyway, so I'll create the catalog when I'm good and ready. I'm not trying to rush the issue. So, I wanted to get you in. Once you get that catalog established, you get that file structure. Start with your hard drive. Start with Finder. Start with Explorer. Create your file structure. You know, if you do babies, engagements, and editorial, have those three categories, and then whatever your shoot type is, put that couple, give it a name, and put it in that folder. It all starts there, and then you can go along from there, importing your images, getting to your develop module as quickly as possible, doing a basic look, copying those settings to the other images. You want a consistent look throughout all the images, and we only want to play with exposure, highlights, and shadows. And we, now that if you've built those presets for your export window that we just did together, you'll have a quick way to get those pictures out of your workflow quickly as possible.